Expansion.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Expansion. It is a real pleasure to be here today. I am joined by none other than Timbalada Souza, my brother from Bahia, Brazil. Pleasure to have you in the building, man. Thank
Pleasure
you so much
for
joining
man.
Us, man.
Couldn't wait to be here.
Yeah, man. Thank you, brother. It's been a little while since I've seen you. You know, for those who don't know Timbalada, we're talking samba royalty. The Neymar of samba in Australia. Definitely, if not the highest profile performer, Brazilian performer in the country, equal first. Director of Rhythm Brazil, which is by far, you know, the finest Brazilian entertainment ensemble in Australia, even doing lots of work overseas, which we will talk a lot about that. So on tonight's show, we're going to be talking about samba, we're going to be talking about capoeira, we're going to be talking about Brazilian culture, food, fitness, the instruments were involved in samba, yeah, and so much more, because this man has lived an amazing life, and it is an absolute pleasure again to have you here, my brother.
Thank you, brother.
Bienvenido. Bienvenido. Benvinguts. No, that's Catalan. welcome to the program, my brother.
Obrigado,
how are you feeling?
Obrigado.
All good, huh?
All good, man.
Meu irmão da vida.
It's been so long, man, since
yeah.
I see you.
Yeah, man.
It's like, yeah, like I was telling you before, yeah, I have no idea that you moved, man.
Lucky you didn't show up at Kuji, man.
Yeah. Every morning I drive. Yeah. Koji, and yeah, I keep look at your place, wonder if I can see you.
Yeah, like, no more, brother.
And then when I was driving here today, I was thinking, man,
this is pretty far for work, no?
Yeah, it's so far. How did Rafa give away that
beautiful
lifestyle in Koji until I got here?
Yeah, man.
And then I realized that this is way better, because
I know,
as I was saying to you before, it's more peaceful.
Of course.
It's more grounded, more connected.
Yes, my brother. Thank you so much, man. It's good that you feel the energy, and I'm not surprised, because we flow on very similar frequencies, you and I. And very happy to have come out to the land, man. It's the space, the peace, the nature, the air, you know, all of those things. But one of the key points of coming out was the space, because then that allowed me to build a studio and build a recording studio at the back. And now we've started the earthworks to start planting some crops, serious crops, because we've done some planting. So lots to come, and hopefully you'll be joining us, you know, more often. Look, man, I will say one thing. A true brother, a true friend, or a sister for that matter, doesn't matter how much time goes by.
Yeah.
When you see them, it's like nothing changed.
That's the thing.
You get what I'm saying? Yeah.
That's how I feel with you, man.
Yeah, man.
It's like I can go years without seeing you.
Yep.
But when I see you, it's like that's a straight real connection.
Where we left off.
You know what I mean?
100%, like, brother. Yeah, and there's none of this bullshit like, oh, bro, where you been? Oh, you forgot me. With you, it's like, man, I haven't seen you forever.
Nah.
All good.
Man, a lot of people
yeah
in the past,
yeah,
you should talk about how I was... you are Rafa, black version.
Yeah, yeah, the black, the Brazilian version.
So many times I heard people say that.
Well, the other funny thing, obviously, is we almost share a birthday.
That's right.
Yeah, by one day, right? So so we're both Taurus babies. And yeah, man, I mean, I think there's many parallels there. You know, lots of love for culture, love for music and instruments and nightlife and entertainment and all these things. Even though I've gone on a different path these past few years, more on the event side and behind the scenes, I very much share a lot of that passion and food and all these things that our cultures are so renowned for, man. Particularly yours, Brazilian culture, and that's probably a good point to start. You know, you are the Brazilian ambassador here in Australia. You took over from Marconi. Shout out to Marconi Pereira.
Nah, Marconi. Marconi always will be alive.
Oh, man, for sure. We love Marconi, man. Lots of great memories. And I remember Marconi being like the, you know, like the godfather, which he still is, but he was like very much at the front and that before I went away.
Yeah.
And then I went away, and in 7 years, lots of things changed. And when I come out, before I met you properly, Ian was like, oh yeah, Timbalada, Timbalada, Rhythm Brazil, Timbalada. I was like, who the fuck is this nigga? Here he is, my man. And then obviously we clicked, and it was, you know, one of those people's like, you feel like you've known them for a long time. Yeah, and we've done lots of awesome things over the years, both together as partners, but you also blessing me with Rhythm Brazil, doing many shows and performances.
Can I say something?
Whatever you want, man. You've got like 3 hours to say whatever you want.
It's a little bit out of topic, but it is within the same topic.
Yeah.
It's like, it's powerful because it's real.
Yeah.
One of the best Christmas that I have in this country, if you know my life.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember that day that you came with your mom.
Yeah, that's right.
And I think your sister came as well.
Yeah.
In Darley,
Darley Road,
in what's it called? Not Balmain, the other one next to Balmain. What's it called?
Roselle. Yeah.
And this is so funny because some things you never forget, man.
Yeah, true, bro.
It's like I always remember that Christmas because we were playing music.
That's right. You guys were dancing and everything. Yeah, Mama was happy watching all you guys party and everything. Yeah, that was beautiful, man.
Anyway,
thank you, bro.
I wanted to put up there because I remember.
No, and if we're going to go down memory road, man, we've got so many amazing stories, and that's what I was talking about. And I really look forward to that because thankfully we've done lots of things together.
Yeah.
God willing, we will continue to do many more things together. You know, we could use a little bit of help from maybe COVID going away. Oof.
Oh, no.
I've committed the sin.
Rafa, you'll be getting a warning letter.
Now, one guess who this person is.
DK.
Yes.
Answer it.
DK. Hold on, bro. I'm going to put you on loudspeaker. You're renowned for bad timing, but actually, I left my phone on during the podcast, man. I got Timbalada here, so I'm going to have to let you go, man.
Oh, okay. Sweet.
Love you, man. Take it easy, loco. Deeks, my man. Love you, brother. I love my brother, Deeks. But he has the worst timing. Like, literally, I sit down to eat and boom, he calls me.
Yeah, Rafa, you will be getting a warning letter.
Sorry about that, Paulie. Yeah, fuck, I've pissed off my producer. We're gonna have a bad show. Nah, sorry. So, anyway, so God willing, in the near future, or long term, short term, we'll be able to do many more. Obviously, the conditions right now for live entertainment are a little bit different. But coming back to Brazil, man, this huge, beautiful country, beautiful culture, lots of light, also lots of darkness there as well. You know, lots of darkness there as well. And that's one of the incredible things about Latin America and our people, and particularly Brazil, because I feel like Brazil is a huge contrasting country and culture. You know, on the one hand, you've got some amazing, incredible people, you know, so happy and like salt of the earth, and even like big faith-based and culture and music and food. And then you've got obviously this huge undercurrent of corruption and death, you know, because let's face it, man, you know, and obviously gang culture and all these things as well. But the biggest gangsters are government, unfortunately.
I think it's like that in any third world country.
No doubt. Like, however, I feel like Brazil, the contrast is so much greater because it's so beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, I can speak on maybe some other countries that have all of those darkness things there, you know, all those elements. But Brazil is such a beautiful country, so the contrast is greater. You understand what I'm saying? And also so famous and so liked.
Yeah.
As it is, you know, Brazil is almost like everyone's second football team, you know, in the world. You know, most people don't even go for their country, they go for Brazil, because
true.
They might, the country might not be that strong in football, you know, samba, carnaval, the food, the beaches, the beautiful girls, bikinis, you know, all of that put together, Amazon, you know. Tell us about Brazil, tell us about where you're from, because you're from Salvador, Bahia, correct?
I'm from Bahia, man. I'm from Bahia. I grew up on this beautiful island in Bahia, which is like 45 minutes from Salvador.
Uh-huh.
You can only get there by boat.
Wow.
You can't go in a car or anything.
Yeah.
So I grew up there, and I used to go to Salvador pretty much every week, every weekend.
Uh-huh.
And that's when I learned how to play the drums.
So this little island, is it in a river or the ocean?
In the ocean.
Oh, wow.
It's actually very famous.
It must be.
It's called Morro de São Paulo.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's beautiful, man. You feel when you go to Bahia.
I'm waiting for you to invite me, man. We're gonna go. We always said we're gonna go, man. Yeah, very hot because it's tropical. Yeah, Salvador is it's north of Brazil. Yeah. Yeah,
it's always hot, man.
Yeah,
I remember I came here, or even before I came here, I was in Portugal.
Yeah.
And then I went to London.
Yeah.
And I remember that I never in my life wear jeans.
Of course.
Always I have shorts.
Yeah.
And I never wear a jumper.
Yeah.
Always shirtless.
Of course, tropical, yeah.
And also, I never wear any thongs or anything.
Okay.
Because my barefoot. Island was like, it's the population there is 12,000 people.
Okay.
I mean, back then.
Back then.
Now, probably double.
Okay.
But
still very small.
Yeah. So it's hot, man. It's really hot. All year round, it's hot.
Uh-huh. And the same would go, obviously, for the city of Bahia.
Salvador
de Bahia. Yeah, sorry.
Salvador.
Yeah, so, and then that also it happens to be the cultural capital of Brazil in many ways. Black culture,
yeah.
Samba, and the roots movement in Brazil comes from Salvador de Bahia, right?
Yeah, I don't know if you know this, but Salvador is actually, if I'm not wrong, we have the second largest population of blacks.
Oh, wow.
After Africa.
Uh-huh. An African city. So there'll be one city in Africa bigger, and then Salvador will be the second one,
yeah.
Kind of thing.
Oh,
wow.
Sorry, not just Salvador, the city, the whole
state.
Bahia. Yeah.
Oh, okay, sure.
So it's actually, and it's the only country, not the only one, but I can't even remember properly, but I mean, not one of the countries that actually kept the Africa culture is still alive.
Sure.
Like if you go to Bahia now, I don't know if you have you been there?
No, my brother.
Oh,
no.
Man.
I'm waiting for you, man.
Okay, we're going to go together, babe.
Oh, man, I'm sure. Please.
If you go to Bahia now,
yeah,
you can experience all this beautiful, the samba,
yeah,
the
religion,
the carnaval.
Yeah.
But then you can also get very scared when you go to experience the religions.
Of course.
Because Santeria. It's really old school Africa. Mm.
Yeah.
You know, and I remember there's a documentary called Music in High Place,
mm-hmm.
and Brian McKnight, he's going to Bahia,
okay.
And he's start to explore all this religion, all this
yeah.
Africa religion that is still alive, and he freaks out, he gets scared, and he walk out, and
yeah,
because for us it's really normal.
E candomblé,
yeah,
yeah. Candomblé, yeah. So West African brought over to the Americas with the slaves.
Yeah.
Brazil obviously has a huge yeah. former slave population. It's quite a high percentage of African Americans, blacks in Brazil.
I think we have it's more blacks than whites.
I would say at most it's probably yeah
half,
60%,
half,
but
like
I think yeah it'd be like 50-50
yeah.
from memory, and that's a big representation because
it
then
is,
you've
man.
Got the, all the mixes as well, the mestizo, you got the indigenous blood in there as well. So you know whites I think would very much be in the minority when you take the country as a whole.
Yeah, yeah, but in Brazil is like, I mean I don't know everybody else. My experience is like. Every family in Brazil is mixed.
That's right.
You're like you've got some blacks in your family.
Yeah.
Or like I'm mixed. My mom
yeah.
is indigenous. My dad
yeah.
is Africa.
Yeah.
My grandma was, my great-great-grandma was from Cameroon.
Okay.
They were slaves, man.
Yeah.
So it's like, but then you look
Cameroon.
At my mom, she's like light skin.
Yeah.
And she got Indian native face
features,
so
yeah.
everyone's mixed over there as well.
Yeah, I think I'm never gonna pretend that there's no racism in Latin America.
Oh, man.
Racism exists everywhere in the world, but I think
worst over there in Brazil.
Yeah, I think classism and racism joins in Brazil and in Latin America.
That's right.
It's not just the fact that you're black; it's the fact that you know. Majority blacks are poor, so it's like double, you know.
That's right.
But I also find that everyday people, let's call them, from el pueblo, from the streets, let's say,
yeah.
are not very racist. if anything, there's more of a thing where, yeah, man, so you're black, so what? And I'm white, and so what, you know?
Yeah.
But when you start going up a little bit in classes, yeah, that's where it gets pretty nasty.
Brazil, I mean, maybe in whole South America, but my experience for me in Brazil is not, I think Brazil is worse because it's not just about if you're black or you're white. It's where you're coming from. That's Are you from the north?
Yeah, I get you.
They discriminate because you come from a poor side. Yeah. You talk different.
Yeah.
You talk like a countryside person.
Yeah.
They discriminate you.
Yeah.
You're from the south, they discriminate you because you're not Brazilian. You're German, you know?
Yeah.
So it's actually really bad, but it's not just about black and white.
Yeah, there's
it's
more
about
to it.
Something like... which family you're from, which side of the city you live.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, I guess there's no racism, it's discrimination.
No, but I think also, I mean, equally, if you want to compare with a country, say, a well-populated large country like the United States.
Yeah.
You know, that you do have these like East versus West and South and black and white and Hispanic. And yeah, Brazil has a little bit of that as well. And that's the cool thing about speaking to you today is the little bit of knowledge that I've sort of gathered from hanging out with you boys and being to Brazil, because I did go there in 2015. Shout out to Leticia and her family. They looked after me very well, man. Yeah, beleza. So I started hearing, you know, because most of us think Brazil, one, samba, you know, carnaval. Yeah. But actually, no, there's not only many different currents of music and cultures and regions and colors and foods, but there's actually counter currents. So, for example, the people from the south, they look at samba and all that as black, you know?
Yeah.
And they might, for example, listen to a bit more reggae.
That's right.
You know, the gaúcho, and I'm just going to keep talking here, but the gaúchos, I remember years ago, there was a big match between Uruguay and Brazil. And I saw a flyer on Facebook in Portuguese, right? It was a photo of Diego Forlan and a photo of Neymar. Diego Forlan, of course, a very famous Uruguayan player, blonde, blue-eyed, because he has Armenian... ancestry. shout out to Paulie. And then Neymar at the time, he had one of those crazy, remember he had those crazy kind of haircuts? Whoa. Yeah, that's right. So they put them all side by side and they go, and it was like, who are you going to go for on Friday? Right? And then there was like, they were talking about comments on both of the photos, and they said, oh, you know, Forlan, you know, he looks like you. Neymar, he doesn't look like you. Forlan, he drinks chimarrão, mate, like you. You know, Neymar doesn't look like you, you know. Forlan, it was something like, doesn't jump around like a clown when he wants to dance or something like that. And he does. And there was all these like real nasty shit. Yeah. And I was sitting there going, what the fuck, man? These guys are going to go for Uruguay because the gaúchos are from the south.
Yeah.
Some of them would say they've got a lot more in common with further south than they do north, but obviously, you know, it's not for everybody, just some of them, you know, that have got that mentality. And even a bit is they want to separate, no? Some people want to separate from the rest of Brazil.
Yeah, that's right. Many years ago, I don't even think I was born, or maybe I was. I'm only 24, so.
still 24, my man.
Still 24. Yeah, I remember that happens, they try to separate.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you know what's funny? It's like, because Brazil is so famous for football and samba.
That's right.
Like
predominant culture.
Yeah, if you're in Brazil and you talk to those people about football or samba, not so much football, but samba, they will discriminate. Yeah. But when they're outside of Brazil,
they met
you,
of course,
and they talk about samba, they act like they,
of course, they're an authority
samba over there, but they don't.
Yeah.
So it's like,
I think we can all relate though, a bit with that. Most countries can probably relate. When you travel overseas, you know, it's like it's a different thing. You know, you're looking at it from far away, and a lot of those predominant things become more accepted, let's say.
Yeah.
But what a beautiful country. I remember the food was incredible, and I remember moqueca, Do capixaba.
Moqueca capixaba.
Moqueca capixaba.
You know the difference, yeah? Does that tell you the difference?
Please tell me the
difference. Okay, so in Vitória.
Yep, which is a state.
Yeah.
Yeah. When they just cook, north of Rio.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
When they cook the moqueca,
yeah,
they only use the coconut milk.
Coconut milk, yeah. Sure.
In Bahia,
yeah,
we use the coconut milk plus the red palm oil.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that that's what heavy, make man. The difference.
Oh, okay, cool.
So there's a big like thing about we have the real moqueca.
Of course, yeah,
bit and of competition. We have the real moqueca.
Yeah.
But we from Bahia have the real moqueca because
of you do.
It's coming from our ancestors.
Completely unbiased opinion from a Baiano. It is beautiful. And you know what, man? I had only ever heard of moqueca when I went there.
Yeah.
You know, at the beginning, it was your typical churrasco places. Yeah, and yeah. I remember they took me to a churrasco place, which was like the size of a football field. In Vitória.
So I never cooked moqueca for you?
Nah, man.
Okay.
You forgot about me, bro.
Let's do it.
Look, I'm going to send you an SMS so you got my number.
All right, cool. No, next time I come.
Just save it under Rafa, you know.
Please. I'll cook the moqueca for you.
Por favor, mi hermano. And then they took me to the moqueca, and I'm going to try and remember properly what it was, because it was served in three pots, the moqueca capixaba in Vitória. One was the one with the coconut milk and the seafood and all the spices and everything, yeah?
Yeah.
Another one was almost like an entree, because it wasn't as full of like stuff, but it was like almost like gooey. But it had like a curry.
Pilão.
Yeah, it was like a... You know,
it's like a mandioca.
Yeah, mandioca flour. That's what it is. Yeah, 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 yeah. So it's thick.
Very
thick.
That's right.
And that was like a little bowl. Large bowl of the main one,
yeah.
Medium bowl, and then a little bowl was like almost sweet, like a banana thing. It was like almost like a dessert without being a proper dessert.
Yeah, they use the banana for. I'm not really familiar with the Vitória one.
Yeah, yeah, but and that could have been particular to that restaurant too. I don't know.
Yeah, no, but it's in Bahia we're doing the same.
Yeah,
but we're doing the pirão, which is the mandioca.
Yeah.
And then we have the big, it's made of, the plates is made of
clay.
Agile.
Okay, like a ceramica.
It's ceramica.
Yeah, yeah, clay pots. Yeah, clay pots. Yeah, it's incredible, man.
Yeah.
Wow.
And that makes the food taste so good.
Anyone in Australia cook that in a restaurant? We can send people somewhere to try it?
No, Brazilian, but there is this place mainly that's called Out of Africa.
Okay.
I don't know if you've ever been there.
No.
I don't even know if it's still open. Yeah.
Okay.
It's called Out of Africa. It's amazing. It's like Moroccan foods.
Incredible.
They cook all the clay.
Yeah, the tagine type stuff. Yeah. So then obviously a lot of this, I mean, I know a lot of the culture and everything, but moqueca very much comes then from Africa,
That's right.
Okay, cool.
It's all from our ancestors, yeah.
Yeah, beautiful, man. Amazing food.
Oh, man.
I had a great time there. Beautiful people. I did notice... Out of most of the countries I visited in Latin America, there was a little bit of that heat, like that fear factor, you know, because of the whole, you know, the robbery and you know, that side of it. I saw lots of barbed wire, lots of like, you know, broken glass on top of the walls and lots of security guards like strapped, like, you know, 7-Eleven guarded with a fucking machine gun. And
you had some crazy experience there, didn't you? I think you were telling me something about
a
party.
Yeah. The party. So I arrived and it was a Monday, and I nearly broke my knee playing football in Uruguay, and so I was on crutches. And I arrived. It was Monday. I'm like, hey, what are you doing? You know, Monday night. And he's like, oh, Monday night's pretty quiet. And I said, nah, man. And he goes, oh yeah. He goes, he made a couple of phone calls. He said, yeah. And he came back and he goes, oh man, there's some parties, but you know, they're like, samba parties. And I'm like, yeah, I love samba. Let's go. You know, imagine me, the tourist, you know, white boy. I'm like, yeah, bro, let's go. And he goes to me, yeah, but you know, samba, you know, it's black people. And I say, hey man, I love black people.
I'm back in the inside.
Yeah, man, I'm brown on the inside. So anyway, and then he goes, oh, but you know, black parties up in the Moro, you know, and I'm like, Moro, and you know, he's speaking to me in Portuguese, and you know, I'm kind of learning, and I'm like, Moro, and I go, that sounds like the hill. I go, man, let's go up the hill, I don't care. And he goes, oh, but it's kind of poor. I took my watch off. I said, man, let's go, you know, don't worry about it. So we get there. The place was, you could tell, it wasn't a favela, but it was.
Yeah.
And we show up there, and they pat searched us like I've never been pat searched before. The guy literally put his whole arm up my crotch, like bang, like that. Checked me everywhere. And then he pointed, he goes, over there. And I'm like, where? And he goes, there. And I look, and there's nothing. There's just like a hole in the wall and nothing. So I walk over, and I'm like, where? And he goes, like that. He points at the hole, you know. So there's a hole in the wall like this. And I look down the hole and there's an eye. Looking. I go, hey. And he goes, ah, blah, 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 blah. And I go, what? And he goes, because like that, put your ear. So I put my ear on the hole and he goes to me, 10 reais, right? Whatever it was. And I'm like, oh, okay. 2. Right? So I grab the money and I stick my arm in. I stick my arm in the hole, man. This thing was like this thick. Stick my arm in all the way, pay the guy. Anyway, we go in there. Man, the place was pumping, yeah? And the guy said to me, look, man, be careful here, yeah? There's a lot of like crazy people here. But everyone was super friendly. And I just remember seeing unas negrotas, man, like 1.85 meters, big black chicks from El Barrio, you know? Like big as in,
yeah,
like overweight, but also quite large, you know? Yeah. Like very curvy. And I just remember laughing to myself because I was watching their high heels and I was wondering, man, those are some strong high heels because these girls were doing a full samba, right.
Yeah.
You know, and I was like, and then anyway, a guy bumps into me and he's like, oh man, sorry, brother. And I say, hey man, I'm from Australia. Oh, Australia, Uruguay. And he walks away and my mate comes over to me and goes, you all right? Are you all right? I said, what's up? And he goes, do you know who that was? I said, no, man. He goes, he runs the favela here. He's the gang boss. I'm like, really? That guy? He goes, yeah, man. Super friendly. You wouldn't know it. You get what I'm saying? No aggro, nothing. And from beginning till end in Brazil, I had an amazing time. I love it, man. If anyone wants to go to an amazing place in the world, Brazil, you know? And I can't wait to go to Bahia.
I mean, I so wanted to come with you.
Yeah, man.
Remember that week?
Yeah, I know.
You were talking, you should come.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I should have come, man.
How long since you've been home?
Oh, man, it's been about... I was just looking before at Leandro.
Yeah.
Time of the accident, 2011. Yeah. So that's the last time I went there.
Wow.
Nine years ago.
Way too long, hermano.
Very long, man.
Wow. Well, let's try and make something. I'm feeling.
I can feel that it's time to.
It's calling.
To go. But it's the worst time for that.
I know, my brother. Yeah.
I've tried to ignore it, but.
Yeah. Well, hopefully sometime soon, man.
Yeah, it's been a really long time.
Yeah.
And I know because usually I need to go back there to recharge.
Of course.
And it's been so long
that
I can feel that it's over, like it's overdone. Mm. Like I should go maybe 5 years ago.
Yeah.
So,
I hear you, man. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know what the connection is to land and to culture. But speaking of culture, so you mentioned going from your island to Salvador, and in Salvador, that's probably where you met the drums because that's what you're most renowned for, Chimba. You know, batucada, Brazilian drumming, dancing, capoeira, and all of that. But the drum plays a huge role, and you're not one of these show guys. You're a fucking master at that shit. I've seen you. I know rhythm. I know percussion, and also you do drum workshops and everything. So tell us about your relationship with music and with the drums.
This is really crazy, man, because my journey to where I am today, it's pretty much, as you know, I'm writing a book that's called Rhythm of Life.
Yes, brother.
Because I feel like my life is being run by rhythms.
Mm.
And what I do is I just listen to the rhythm.
Yeah.
And I just follow, I go for.
Yeah.
So I remember, many people don't know this, man, this is very
personal.
Deep personal stuff, but I used to be a homeless child. You know, I used to live on the streets.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I don't even know. We talk about this.
I think we mentioned it, but yeah. not in these terms.
No, right? It should be me. Pretty much ran away from home when I was 10 years old, bro.
Wow.
And I live on the street for years.
Why?
So why? Because when my mom passed away, like my mom died when I was, that's quite emotional to talk about this, but it's cool.
It's up to you, my brother.
So my mom died of breast cancer.
Okay.
And she was in the hospital for 3 years from when I was six. From when I was three to I was six, she was in the hospital, then she passed away. And then my dad got left behind with five kids. I was 6 years old. My youngest brother was 3 years old. So my dad tried everything he could to do a good job. But after a few, not even maybe 6 months, he lost it. He started to drink. He became an alcoholic.
Wow.
But he started to get very aggressive as well. He started to come home, and if we did something that was nothing, he would go crazy at us and get belts and belt us. And I think he was what's the word? Vulnerable as we were.
Of course.
With the loss of my mom. So I ran away, man. I decided eventually, I was just sick and tired from being home. We sleep by myself every night with my younger brothers and my sister as well. My dad pretty much never got home, you know, so.
What about food and?
Ah, man, we went.
Hungry.
Hungry for weeks and weeks, man. And I remember the neighbors, they used to be the one that used to feed us. They used to give us food, and by that time it was let's say I was seven by then. And then when I was, let's say, 8 or 9, I started to go to knock on the neighbor's door and ask them if they want somebody to clean their backyard or something.
Backyard, whatever, odd jobs.
Just to return the food.
Wow.
You know, so eventually I got sick of it and I decided to run away from home. And then I ran away from home from a city called Valença, which pretty much 20 minutes from the island.
Sure.
And I told myself, I told myself, nothing's happening here.
Yeah.
I might as well go and start work for myself, you know, do something. I mean, I was 10 years old.
That's incredible.
Yeah. And what I did was I keep watch all these tourists come to the city, get on the boat to go to the island.
Yeah.
Right? This is all in my book, by the way.
Okay. Soon to be released, I hope, man.
I'm watching them and I'm watching other kids help them with the luggage. So I'm breaking down how they connect to the music.
Yeah, please, man. Take your time.
So then I'm like, oh, cool. These kids is helping all these gringos with the luggage, and they put their hand on the pocket to give them some money.
Yeah.
So I started to doing that. I started to go to the bus stop, help the gringos with the luggage, bring it to the wharf where the ferry was.
Yeah.
And then they give me some money. I'm like, oh, cool. I was 10 years old. Then from that, I find out that I could also make more money if I take the gringo all the way from this city to the island, to the hotel. So the money would double. So I start to get on the boat every single day from the city to the island.
Door to door.
And to the hotel. So I make more money. And I was doing this for a year.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. Then when I turned 11, I was like, all right, now fuck this shit. How are we allowed to swear?
Yeah, man.
Fuck this shit. I'm going to just stay on the island. And I just stay on the island, man. And I stay there.
So is that your original island?
Yeah.
Morro de São Paulo?
Morro de São Paulo, yeah. Morro de São Paulo. Yeah. which is like 20 minutes from the city.
Okay, sure. Yeah. Yeah. So you're back in your island now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I went from the city
yeah.
to the island
yeah.
because I was born in the city.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but the city is like 20 minutes.
Ah, okay, okay, okay. So you're born there and then, all right, I thought that's you started right. in the yeah. island. Okay, cool. So this is how you end up on the island.
That's right. Huh. So I take the tourists there.
Sure.
And then I come back.
Sure.
I go home.
Okay.
Then one day I decided that I wouldn't come back anymore.
Yeah.
So I just stay on the island.
Okay.
And good I lifestyle. Have some cousins there as well.
Sure.
And, but like far away cousins.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
we're
yeah,
not
yeah.
really that close.
Yeah.
So I decided to stay on the island.
Pretty, pretty heavy life decisions to be making at 10, yeah, at 10 years old, 11 yeah. years old, you know? That's crazy.
But if I come home...
Nothing.
It was just like shit, man, you know? So anyway, I stay on the island and I have nowhere to sleep. So I sleep on the beach
uh-huh.
for like for a year or two.
Wow.
I just found a place on a roof somewhere
mm.
and I just... park there, man. I said, yeah. I'm going to sleep here.
Was it like so a little cave or
huh?
like a little cave or something made out of wood or what was it? The
It was the port and they have like a office that okay. was wide open.
Sure.
And inside of the office, there was a ceiling
sure.
that was very strong.
Sure.
That has a hole like 1 meter high.
Uh-huh.
And I used to go there and sleep all the time.
Wow.
And some days... sometimes they would close the office.
Yeah.
What I used to do is I used to swim
around
from the port to the boat to sleep.
Oh shit.
Yeah. And then I had then I wake up like
very early.
Because the boat was fish boats, so these guys would have to leave 6 a.m.
Early, man, yeah.
So I have to be up and swim back.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it was crazy. Great story, man.
What a way to start life.
Yeah.
That's that intense, crazy, my friend. Losing your mama, then going through all of that.
Yeah. Wow. This is like not even 1%, bro.
Yeah.
And so then I start to hang on the island, start to help the tourists, take stuff from the port to the hotel.
Mm.
My dad was like looking for me everywhere.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He spent like a good 6 months looking for me. And the police start to tell me your dad's looking for you, and I would make up a story to the police. Oh, if I go home, my dad's gonna smash me. He's a drunk.
Mm.
He's a beautiful man. I'm not saying it in a bad way, but.
But he was going through that shit.
He was lost.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. So I used to tell the police, look,
yeah.
if he's coming here, let me here. I'm doing way better here than go back home.
What about school?
Man, all this stuff, I have to find all by myself.
Uh-huh.
I put myself into school, man. Like, I actually, after, like, now, for the first, I think from when I was 6 to just before I run out, I was going to the school in the city, in Valencia.
Yeah. You were still home, yeah.
Yeah, then after that, for 2 years,
nothing.
I forgot about school.
Survival.
And then I put myself back into school
uh-huh.
when I was, like, 13.
Wow.
I put myself back to school again.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, then I met new people in the island, new friends, you know. Like, I start to dance on a dance group. I start to learn, like, how to dance, axé,
uh-huh.
samba. I start to play, like, the timbal. That's how I got the nickname Timbalada.
Uh-huh.
One friend of mine, his nickname was Pitu, I remember.
And everyone's Marcelo, got a nickname in Brazil.
There was two of them.
Everyone's got a nickname in Brazil.
Yeah, everybody does. Yeah. Especially if you're in the...
Yeah, entertainment or sport yeah. or... Yeah, that's yeah. right, yeah, yeah.
And he said to me like, hey man, let's we jump every night at the beach for uh-huh. the gringos.
Yeah.
And I start to go to the gym with them and they show me how to do it. And then once a week we go to Salvador and to get some classes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, because the proper knowledge would have been back in the city.
Yeah,
yeah. yeah. And so because there was a lot of tourists around, obviously, you know, the samba thing and the music and the performing, it was like busking, right? And that's kind of how it started
right.
up.
Yeah. So every week, almost every night, we have in the island, we have a thing called luau. You know the luau?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like the full moon.
Like Hawaiian luau, like luau party.
That's right. Yeah, every night. So those boys were playing the drums for the gringos. Yeah. And I got in, I said, man, I want to learn how to do this. Like, yeah. Then they show me, and I was part of them, which like in a month.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Like then we did the luau, then we traveled to Salvador. They were going there, they would take me. And that's how it started, you know?
Sure.
Like, and those boys also come from very vulnerable family.
Sure.
You know, and they found happiness on playing the drums.
Yeah.
And I think because I was very vulnerable at the time, and they showed, they saw that.
Yeah.
Like, I remember all these guys feel sorry for me because they saw me and they were like, oh man, this boy is here by himself.
Mm.
You know, like, so they were starting to get very protective of me.
Uh-huh. You were the younger yeah. kid. Yeah.
It's actually funny because when I went to Brazil in 2011, last time, I went there and I bought a block of land on the beach, right? The guy that I bought the block of land looked at me and say, Timbalada.
Yeah.
You that kid that used to sleep on the beach.
Wow.
I was like, yeah, man, that's me.
Uh-huh.
And he was like, oh, he started crying, man.
Wow.
He was like, I swear to God, I thought you're not going to make it. I thought you're going to be a...
Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah. Street kid or ladrón, drug dealer or... Yeah.
Stolen or selling drugs or whatever.
Yeah.
But you actually made.
Yeah.
I can't believe that.
That's beautiful, man.
And I was like, when he was telling me these things, I was like, man.
Yeah.
It's so good to hear this from you because I was so young.
Mm.
Because he started to tell me the story of how he used to drive a tractor very early in the morning. He worked as a rubbish guy.
Mm.
He drove a tractor and picking up rubbish from the beach. And he said he used to see me there, right?
Yeah.
And I was like, oh man, I actually forgot all of that. Because I was too young, so I broke it all.
You blocked it out. Yeah.
You know? And he was telling me the story. It was like, oh, I was like, wow. Uh-huh. Anyway, so.
Full circle.
Yeah, I started to make money with the gringos, playing music for them, doing shows, you know? And eventually I got my own place, me and one of the boys.
Sure.
You know,
on the island.
On
the island.
On the island, yeah. Uh-huh.
Sure.
So one of the boys, he was a capoeira guy, Pelúcia, his nickname Pelúcia. And I remember he said to me, man, we should get our own place. Like, he's got his family, there, everything, but he still wanted to live by, you know. Yeah. So, we just got our own place.
And so the schooling, the drum schooling is happening in Salvador do Bahia, in the capital city.
All the drum is coming from Salvador, definitely.
Sure.
We go to Salvador, we go to Pelourinho.
Yeah.
We go to pretty much everywhere you go in Salvador, there's drums.
Well, that's where the world famous Olodun comes from. That's probably the most renowned one, right? Olodun.
That's where Michael Jackson did that.
Yeah. All I want to say is that they don't really care about us. That one, no? Yeah. That's right, yeah. And in the end of the song, it breaks into the Olodun playing. Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Yeah, so Salvador is definitely the reference where we go from the island.
Sure.
To learn everything.
Because
whatever we did in the island was just fun.
Yeah,
of course. You know?
Yeah,
but then when you want to...
Of course, get grow serious, game, learn. Yeah,
you go
to
Salvador.
Yeah,
you get some classes with some boys.
Sure.
Or with a school.
Yeah.
Then you go back to the island and perform.
Fair enough.
Well,
right. Yeah. And capoeira.
Capoeira. I did capoeira. Like, I did capoeira for 5 years, I think.
Sure. Around the same time.
Around the same time, yeah.
Sure.
Because in there's a saying in Brazil. Todo baiano é artista.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Every Bahia boy is an artist.
Everyone from Bahia is an artist.
That's right.
It's like Cuba. Cuba's the same too. Yeah.
So you don't just learn the drums. You have to learn the drums, the capoeira,
right.
The lambada.
Yeah, that's right.
And that's how you become the showman, right?
Yeah. That's right. You can do everything. Yeah, you can cover everything. Yeah.
But the thing with capoeira was the reason why I did stick to capoeira
to
become a master was because capoeira is a lot of discipline.
Yes.
And I don't do well with that.
Okay.
I don't do well with people tell me what to do.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, so I'm like, every day I go there.
Yeah. Tell people at home, capoeira, I mean, a lot of people know it's a Brazilian martial art, but but the history of capoeira, it's African roots again,
it's
right?
It's African roots, yeah. It was brought from Africa to Brazil.
Yeah.
And we used to, the ancestors used to...
Yeah.
Practice as a way of dance, but really they were like kind of learn
to defend themselves.
Yeah, like pretend to be a dancer. So when the master look at them,
that's right.
They think they were dancing, but they were actually practicing.
Exactly. Yeah, that's the story I heard. I heard, this is what I heard. I heard that the slaves and the blacks were not allowed to carry weapons.
That's right.
So that's why it's so important to learn a martial art. But also they weren't allowed to learn martial arts. So they would pass it off as dancing.
That's right.
And I also heard that some capoeira people, when they were actually fighting, they used to put blades in their toes.
That's right. Yeah.
Wow.
To cut.
That's right.
Yeah.
Because a lot of capoeira is kicks. It's very kick.
It's fascinating, man.
Capoeira, to me, it's the craziest looking martial art. You show me one martial art that looks as crazy as capoeira.
They even have a UFC now.
Yeah.
Like Anderson Silva, McGregor. McGregor does capoeira as well.
Yeah. So he's got that download of the ground thing. Very famous martial art from Brazil. Oh, you know?
Capoeira definitely is a... How to say cartão postal is?
It's a postcard.
Postcard.
Yeah, postcard of Brazil. One of many.
Man, it's
one everywhere. Of many, postcards from Brazil.
Actually, nowadays you find better capoeiras outside of Brazil.
They've perfected it. Yeah, that happens a lot with different things in
Israel,
life, yeah.
In Tel Aviv.
Really?
It's one of the countries that they have so many amazing capoeiristas.
Wow. Okay.
They're not even Brazilians.
That's right.
It's really
they've
powerful
really taken
me.
It
it's
up. Strong. Yeah. And so there is some instrumentation.
Yeah.
With capoeira, but not a lot. It's almost like enough to make the master look and go, oh, yeah, we're playing instruments and we're dancing.
Yeah, that's
right. But you've got describe the instruments for us.
We have the berimbau.
Yeah.
Which is like a
the big one. Yeah.
Wood with
it's like
string.
One string. Yeah.
Right. Then we've got the pandeiro.
Yep.
Which is like a atabaque.
Yep.
Kashishi.
It's not that big. It's more like chill.
Yeah.
And it's just like a rhythm for the fighters to work with.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Is there a spiritual element to capoeira?
Sorry.
Is there a spiritual element to capoeira?
Oh man, everything's spiritual in capoeira. Yeah. The music, the beats.
Yeah.
It's all connected to
faith.
Candomblé.
Yeah, candomblé.
It's like,
okay, sure.
It's like it's all there's a massive connection there.
Sure.
You know, even when you listen to the drums, it's like, at least for me, every time I listen to the drums, where it's candomblé or capoeira or afro, it's always waking me up like, oh, okay, what's going on?
Yeah.
So it's very spiritual, man.
The ancestors calling. You know, in Uruguay, we often call the drum the first instrument because it was the first musical instrument. So the lineage that comes down through drumming is, you know, by far the oldest and the most powerful. Very powerful symbol. And it was used as a messaging thing, you know, between tribes and along long distances. And it was used in war and all these different things. And it's where the rhythm comes from, my brother.
It's crazy, man. It's like sometimes I regret not follow through and focus just on capoeira.
Sure.
Because it is very spiritual, bro.
Yeah.
Like everything is spiritual.
Yeah. And I ask as well because, you know, Asian martial arts, all of them have roots in or at least they're linked to, meditation and a spiritual side. And I thought so very much the same thing because aware of, you know, the candomblé and the santeria, which is all kind of part of the same thing.
The way that they sing as well, the things that they're saying,
sure,
it's very powerful. It's like they can bring you down.
Yeah, what are they saying?
Oh, they can say they can say things about you.
Sure.
Like to put you down, or they can say things about you to lift you up.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So there's a bit of that. Yeah. So there's a bit of like almost like battling in the in the words as well.
Like there's a song that goes, você diz que é professor.
You say you're a professor.
Like you think you're a professor. You call yourself a professor, but professor of what? Yeah. I always see you by yourself. I never see you training with no one.
Oh, really? Yeah, so it's full battle rhymes.
Yeah,
and
but
shit.
This coming from different schools.
Oh, sure. You know,
like if I'm from one school.
Yeah, they get together and they start. Yeah, of course. Yeah, like a crowd cheering in a football stadium, you know? They got little chants and stuff to back their fighters.
Yeah.
Yeah,
or you can be in a capoeira cycle in a roda.
Yeah.
And there's a beautiful girl you can sing it for.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Like, me leva, morena, me leva.
Really?
Me leva pro seu bangalô. Yeah.
So we're supposed to be fighting. We're supposed to be at war with blades in our feet, watching the master, making sure we're not getting busted. But we still got time to sing to a woman.
Man. It's all connected.
It's all connected.
It's all connected, man.
Oh, beleza. And aren't there some beautiful women in Brazil? Wow.
Brasil.
A mulher brasileira é, se não é a mais bonita do mundo, é, tá lá arriba. Eu acho.
Yeah. I have to watch what I say here, but
listen.
No, I'm joking.
Your love and your opinion of your woman is separate. We're talking from a humanity point of view.
No,
here.
No, it's
mankind,
true.
You know. Yeah.
I always tell people it's not so much about the beauty.
Yeah.
When you look at them, it's o charme. Tem charme.
I agree 100%.
Because when you go to the favelas.
Yeah.
Probably you never, I don't know if you've been to Brazil, but you...
We'll take him there.
Yeah. If you go to the favelas, you can look at these girls, right?
Yeah.
That if you look, think whether they're beautiful or not, you say they're beautiful. But it's not that. It's the way that they walk.
I understand 100%.
There's something that they do.
It's the essence. Yeah. The essence.
Yeah.
Yeah, I sense here. Look, particularly in a continent like Latin America, which is renowned for beautiful women, you know, you could say, you know, Venezuela, Colombia, Argentina, they've all got, you know, there's so much beauty in the Caribbean, you know, Cuba, Puerto Rico. But I find that the inner beauty and the essence of the Brazilian woman is very special. They tend to be much calmer than the other sort of fiery, you know, Hispanic Latin women from the rest of Latin America, and just an inner beauty. But it goes for the men as well, because Brazilian culture, as I see it, samba, even capoeira, there's a feminine side to it.
It is.
You know, and the same goes for the rest of Latin America. The Hispanic man or the Latin man, in my opinion, and what makes him so attractive as a culture is the fact that we've got the feminine in there, which is that thing about appreciation for music and dancing, and you know, whereas all the other cultures are just more about that. You know, I'm a bloke.
Yeah.
Know? Whereas in Latin America, there's a lot more round, smooth Ginga. Edges. Yeah, jinga. Eso mismo, and particularly the women, beautiful women, and a lot softer spoken perhaps than other parts of the world, and the other thing also that Brazil very much has a clear advantage over, in my opinion, over the rest of Latin America, is the fitness element is very present. I would say, having traveled around the world a couple of times, Australia and Brazil are probably the most fitness sort of oriented countries in the world.
Yeah.
But nutrition, fitness.
Yeah. You know why? It's the beach lifestyle.
Yeah, a lot of it has to do with that, no doubt about
like
it.
Like if you go to South, Rio, Bahia,
bikini.
Everyone should have nice bikini.
That's right.
Should be. Yeah, you're right. There's the first time I went to Rio, I went to a beach called Praia da Barra.
Uh-huh.
You've been there?
No, but I haven't even been to Rio. Man.
Oh, you haven't been to Rio, mate.
I only went to Vitória, believe it or not.
Oh, mate, we've got to go back, though.
I know. Can't wait. Yeah.
When you go to Praia da Barra,
yeah,
it's like You want another planet.
Yeah.
Because that's where
all the beautiful Instagrammers and movie stars.
Yeah, that's where everyone hangs. Yeah. So it's like Bondi.
Yeah, it's
everyone
the
there want to be cool.
But on another level.
It's actually amazing, man. First time I went there.
Look, I don't think it's only about the beach culture, because Brazil, going back to the sport, is a huge thing in Brazil. Like, you guys have serious basketball and volleyball and obviously football, but even like BJJ and capoeira, like, it's a very physical culture.
Yeah, but if you go to places that doesn't really have, it's not
the
close
infrastructure.
To the beach, you actually don't see as much
as you see
in Rio, in the south.
Yeah, it's like the eastern suburbs of Sydney and all that. Yeah,
yeah.
You get the concentration.
But you're right. It's like, it's not just there, but it's more in there.
Yeah.
Because everyone want to go to the beach. Everyone look nice.
I know, man. Yeah. And the other thing too, definitely, I think the advantage is that the food, the quality of the food and the type of high protein diet that you guys have, with so much beans and beef and everything, that's what's... I think created this real, strong, the women, very powerful and thick, and the guys too, And of course, all the ancestral lineages as well.
It's a mix.
DNA,
with the food, because our food is actually, all Brazilian food is like, come from Africa, really.
Yeah.
It's from the slaves. Like, look at feijoada.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, of course.
You know about feijoada.
Feijoada, of course.
You know the
brother.
Story about
feijoada. I don't, but please tell. So feijoada would probably be Brazil's most famous dish.
If
there was one dish, feijoada.
Yeah, muqueca is the most famous in Bahia.
Yeah. No.
By everybody, but feijoada
is
all over the world.
Number one. Yeah, that's
you don't have to be Brazilian to know feijoada.
So tell us feijoada, what's in it and where it comes from, man. That's a cool story.
Feijoada, it comes from, come with the slaves as well, like Africa,
West
of
Africa, yeah.
What happened was the slaves, they will serve the dinner, right? And whatever was left over,
that's right,
they would take home for their family.
Uh-huh.
Like if you cook, if you put some meat and bone,
ribs,
on whatever the master was eating,
and
there was left over, they would take home, they'll put all together, mix it up, and that's a feijoada.
Sure.
So that's why you have the chorizo.
It's true, because it has
the dry meat, how to say fato?
Fat. Matamre, like the stomach lining.
I
get what you're saying. Just different parts of, because even different animals,
the tongue,
right? Yeah,
the cow tongue.
But different animals, because you got pork in there, beef,
the
chicken.
Tongue, the ears.
Sure.
Everything, whatever.
Basically, whatever was left over,
they
right?
put there.
They put there for flavor and also for protein, but then they added.
That's right.
The feijão.
That's right.
Which is the black bean that's so famous in Brazil. Yeah.
You can have the but the feijão doesn't make the feijoada, because
no,
the feijoada is the whole mixture
yes.
of everything.
Yes.
Because if you cook a feijão without
that's a separate dish.
Feijão.
I mean, the slaves now, they've taken all this meat.
Yeah.
And then they add.
That's right. Yeah.
They add the beans.
That's right.
And they make some sort of like a stock.
Yeah.
Yeah. And this is the most famous Brazilian dish. And if anything, if anyone knows, like when you eat feijoada, you don't eat for 3 days.
Oh, yeah.
Very filling.
And you might be going to the toilet for a week.
For sure. With all the noise works all the way there.
Oh, look. I give you the option. You can choose feijoada or muqueca.
All right, so we'll do both, so then we can see each other twice.
Cool.
Yeah. All right, so feijoada.
That's two of my favorite dishes to cook, by the way.
Oh, man, please. Either of those, I'm more than happy to.
I'm just
going to
need a date on
those
dinner dates.
Yeah.
Paulie's getting in on that action as well.
You invited you, Paulie.
Well, you know, we might even be able to do a thing here, man. I'll get some picanha from our brother Biru down at Braza. Who's been looking after me for many years. Braza, definitely, if you guys want to have good Brazilian churrasco, the rodizio, the all-you-can-eat, Braza in Darling Harbour is the place to go.
Yep.
And of course, all I do is sit there and ask for picanha, lamb picanha and picanha.
Yeah.
So when I do eat meat, that's a great place to go. And he's been looking after me, thanks to you, with the meat that we get on the side from the restaurant. So whenever you have those yummy barbecues at my house that we're known for, Paulie's had a few, is with picanha. Remember we went to South Coast, man, and I took like fucking 15 kilos of picanha or something. We had picanha every day.
But yeah, what did we get upset about? Where was the hearts?
The chicken hearts.
Yeah.
So
we left the chicken hearts
at Coogee. You got a good memory there, Paulie. My woman.
Saddest day for me and Tao.
My woman was upset.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, she loves the chicken hearts.
Oh, man.
Because she's...
Thai.
She's Thai. They eat chicken.
They love all that weird stuff. Yeah. The weirder, the better.
In Brazil, there's no barbecue without chicken heart, man.
Really? Okay.
You've got to have a chicken
heart. I only ever tried them from Braza, following, Braza. But I'm not a big fan of myself. I'll have it, but I'm not a huge fan of it, as my woman is. She's like, whenever...
You know what, Timbalada? You know what the saddest part was? Rafa showed no remorse.
Actually, it wasn't... look, not guilty, Your Honor. It wasn't my fault. She's the one that packed it. I'll take the heat. I don't care. But I'm all good. picanha. Yeah, anyway, Braza, picanha, Brazilian. Great food, man. Great food. Feijoada, moqueca. But back to your story, man. So you're in your like mid-teens around now. Or 15, 16. Or I'm not really sure. But you're learning the drum and the, you know, from the best, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I learned with the two or three boys, that was Pitu, Pelúcia.
On the island.
And Marcelo.
Yeah.
Marcelinho. Yeah. Look at the names.
Sounds like a gang.
It's like the name of the boys on the seed of God. You know, the Laranjinha.
That's right, man.
Zep de Chico.
Well, Pelúcia is a big nickname in Uruguay as well, because it's a puff of hair. Pelúcia.
Yeah.
Right, yeah.
He's this big black, like, he's not black, he's blue.
Oh,
he's
wow.
Like, he's that dark. Uh-huh. My best friend, man, we could pretty much grow up together, you know? And he's one of the best capoeira you ever seen in your life.
Wow, really?
He's still like that today.
Uh-huh.
Still amazing.
Right.
Yeah. So, yeah, we learned with the boys and whatever they did, they took me with them. You know, they kind of adopted me.
Sure.
You know?
Little brother.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And we go to Salvador once a week to get started a little bit more.
Mm.
Then come back to the islands.
Yeah,
and
make that money.
Money, play for the gringos.
Sure.
Yeah.
So when did you start traveling? Because you've been to a few countries.
Yeah, so we were in Morro, with the islands for doing this for a few years.
Mm.
And then by the time I was 17 and a half, that's when there's a lady in the islands. She's Portuguese.
Uh-huh.
She came from Portugal. She's very rich.
Rich.
She's very rich. I saw something in it right now. Very rich.
Bondi Beachy.
Yeah, Bondi Beachy. Randwicky.
Randwicky. Randwick.
Yeah, she was just very rich Portuguese lady. Sofia.
Sure. Yeah.
We're still friends.
Good, man. Shouts to Sofia.
Yeah. And she's... by that time, I was like, okay, I was 17, almost 18, and I started doing some naughty shit, man.
Oh, really?
I started to get heavy on drugs.
Ah, okay.
Like doing cocaine.
Uh-huh.
And starting to doing aviãozinho. Have you heard of aviãozinho?
No.
Aviãozinho
is, what is it?
When you're not the dealer,
okay.
But you get the money from the gringos, go and get from the dealer and make some money.
Okay.
I started doing that a lot, you know. Yeah. For 1 year, I went crazy, man, on drugs.
Yeah. Perfect age. Walking. Perfect age, like, to do it.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Because I was a dancer, plus musician.
Of course.
On the beach.
In the scene.
Women everywhere from all over the world.
Yeah.
And every night I was
drugs
like...
drugs were around, yeah.
And whoever was there on holidays, that's what they want.
Of course.
And because you are the local, you have to provide the fun for them.
Yep.
So I went a little bit...
off the rails.
I went from being this really good boy who was scared of everything because I was by myself to be this really rock star of the islands, you know? And I started doing drugs, selling drugs, doing everything. And Sophia bought a hotel and she told me, hey, I want you to start teach dance in my hotel to the tourists every day at 5 o'clock. So I started to doing her dance class. I used to do a share. And she, you know, she's falling in love with me. She adopted me as a kid, as a son. She was like, she probably was like 35 years old back then when I was 17, almost 18. And she's falling in love with me. She's like, oh, come here every day. I used to go there. She loves my energy to be around. And she was watching me doing all these things. She say, this doesn't suit you. That's not you. Like all these other boys here make sense, but not you. Like there's something about you that I wanted to help you. She said to me, how do you like to come to Portugal and teach dance in Portugal?
Wow.
And doing shows for the TV. So I'm like, what? No way.
Tomorrow.
Yeah, I was like, nah, this is great. Yeah. That's like my dream.
Yeah.
You know? And she said to me, oh, but the thing is, you're not 18 yet. Like your father have to sign.
Fuck.
I was like, oh man, my father's not gonna sign. It's like my father is like always drinking and the old school mentality.
Yeah.
If I know, by that time, by the way, I was already buy my dad everything, his food, his alcohol, whatever he needed, we send money to him. And he was like, no, I can't. So anyway, when she asked me, you need to get a passport, I said, but only your dad can sign.
That's right.
I have to go to my dad's house,
yeah,
hang there for a week, get him drunk every single day, buy him everything, whatever he wants, he loves his alcohol.
Yeah.
And trick him to sign. I said, no, but I'm just going to go and come back. And that's how I got him to actually sign. So he signed my passport. Sophia said to me, oh, okay, we live in, I think it was in July. And she wanted to leave in November, December. I was like, oh, shit. No, sorry. It was about June. And she wanted to leave in August, like in a few months.
Sure.
Because she said there was summer over there.
Yeah,
and she could get me a lot of
work. Yeah. Summer in the Northern Hemisphere, yeah.
Yeah, so what she July, did was, August. So start to work with our passport, my passport and everything, my visa. And she was calling people in Portugal, say, hey, I've got this boy, he's amazing, amazing dancer, he play every instrument. He was calling all these Brazilian guys in Portugal that she knew it.
To link you up, yeah.
Yeah, all the club owners that have a Brazilian party.
Sure.
And so when I went to Portugal, they were expecting this superstar. so Sophia, she pretty much found me and she took me over there.
Yeah.
And I remember when I got to Portugal, I stayed 9 hours in the airport. They wouldn't let me in, man.
Ah, for some reason. Like papers and stuff. Yeah.
Like,
what year is that, roughly?
Fuck, I don't even remember. I'm 25 now, so.
Okay.
Now, that was 1999?
Okay, cool, yeah.
99?
But it was still pretty strict for Brazilians to
very.
Yeah.
Yeah.
To travel into Portugal.
Yeah, but lucky for me, she was so powerful in Portugal. Just to make a few phone calls, like,
and
he's got everything. Because a lot of Brazilians, remember, used to go from Brazil to Portugal.
Of course.
Back then, Portugal was really good place to make money.
Uh-huh.
Like, not as good today, but back then, Portugal was amazing. Everyone was going from Brazil to Portugal.
Sure.
And the immigration thought I was there just to make money, which I was.
Of course.
But in my passport, I was there for tourism. Holiday.
Okay.
To stay just for the summer, the Portugal summer.
Yeah. They knew you were there.
For holiday, sure. And they knew because
you and everyone else.
Yeah, and they look at me, the way that I was dressed, of my haircut, I have gold rose.
They were
like, oh, this is a Brazilian capoeira.
Yeah, Basca, capoeira, performer, straight out. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, and then after that.
Would have been a big shock, man.
Oh, man. In
Going
Portugal.
To Europe,
yes. Oh, ooh. You know, the most crazy experience I ever had in the first week.
Yeah.
The sunset was around 9:30, 10 That's o'clock right. at
yeah.
night.
Same as Spain, yeah.
I was like, what?
Yeah, it's crazy, yeah.
And
it's the longest evenings in the world, man. It's crazy. Yeah,
it's crazy.
Yeah, I love it.
I remember she came home, like she called me around 9 o'clock. She said, oh, get ready, we're going for dinner. I'm like, Sophia, it's 9:30. Like,
yeah.
I'm ready for bed. She goes, no, it's dinner time.
Yeah.
They have dinner so late as well.
Yeah, you know what? Yeah, it's funny you say that, but Brazil is an early riser. And therefore, an early dinner going down. That's right. Right?
6 o'clock.
Yeah, yeah. But the rest of Latin America and Spain and Portugal is the complete opposite, hermano. It's... I mean, I can't say the whole rest of Latin America just like that, but generally speaking, it's quite late. And Spain takes it to another level, particularly through summer. Yeah, they sit down for dinner at 11, 12 o'clock at night. You know, it's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, then she's... anyway, Sophia started taking me everywhere, all this TV.
Yeah.
Like, they don't have it here, but in Brazil,
in
a lot of countries in South America,
there's
always a guy... in front of the stage, go like this.
Yeah.
Hyping up the people.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Kind of what you do with the MC.
Yeah, but without
but the, just with this.
Yeah. Off camera. Yeah. Off camera.
So I was getting money just to do it.
Uh-huh.
And they put some Brazilian music and I start to dance.
Uh-huh.
And then just the show starts to pump up the crowd. Stop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
They start to send me to doing shows with all these birthday parties, weddings.
Mm.
Then I was there for, I think I was in Portugal for 1 year, you know. Winter came, and the cold. I wanted to go back, man.
Yeah, I can't imagine, brother.
Yeah.
Coming from a tropical island all your life to...
singlets.
Yeah,
all the time.
Yeah, wow.
And I have to wear like 5 jeans and...
Yeah.
25 jumpers.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, that was a big shock.
Yeah.
And, but before... it's actually funny because in the same year, just a year before, no, the same year actually, when Sophia brought me to Portugal, I hook up with an Australian girl on the beach, right? Lisa, which is the mother of my kids.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay.
So this is so crazy, man.
Yeah.
I hook up with her and she gave me phone number, I don't even remember how, I think it was MySpace.
Probably MySpace or whatever it was.
Yeah, back in the days. And she was Australia, but she lived in London.
Okay.
So when I was, I have Orkut, whatever. So we hook up in Brazil, we stayed together for like maybe 2 or 3 weeks.
Okay. While she was there on holidays.
Yeah, she was there for holidays.
Sure.
And then I said to her, guess what? I'm coming to Portugal.
Yeah.
And she goes, oh, that's awesome. I have no idea that Portugal was right next
to
England.
Yeah, that's right.
I have no idea. I'm just a kid from these islands.
That's right, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
She's like, oh, it's only like a few hours on the train.
Mm.
I'm like, oh, cool. So maybe when I'm there, you can come and visit me.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So she's... Yeah, so I remember I set myself up in Portugal for like 9 months. And then, like, just 8 to 9 months, I got in touch with her and I said, hey, because to be honest with you, I didn't want to get in touch with her at the beginning because I wanted to have fun.
Of course.
Yeah. I wanted to meet some girls.
Yeah. You want to be free.
But after when they started to get bored, I was like, okay. Yeah. I got in touch with her. Then she came. Mm. She actually drove.
You can drive.
Over 20 years.
Yeah.
But I think she drove from, I don't know, England to Portugal.
Yeah, you can drive.
I don't know if that's possible.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
I can't remember because it's been over 20 years.
Yeah, you can, yeah.
But then we got there and we spent like a month traveling in Portugal, everywhere. Nice. And then I was like, oh, I'm actually very bored here in Portugal. Like,
yeah,
I want to go to
London.
And then she, So she went back to London.
Yeah.
She said, hey, there's a lot of Brazilian place
that you can that work.
Does shows and yeah. I can hook you, I can go there and see if they need people.
Yeah.
And she did, man.
Wow.
She went there and she's started to talk to Brazilian people. Oh, I've got this guy, he lives in Portugal, he wants to come here. Can you give him some work? He's kept doing capoeira, he's kept doing dancing.
Another woman came and opened the door, right? Another That's woman, incredible, man. Yeah.
It's the rhythm, man.
Yeah.
The rhythm of life.
Yeah, isn't that amazing? And especially a girl that you met, you know, in a bit of romance on a beach, you know,
yeah.
completely randomly on the other side of the world. That's so cool.
It's funny that you say that, man, because this whole time, everything that was happening to me, I always felt my mom's presence.
Wow.
Which we will get to that very soon when we, you know.
Yeah.
But I always felt my mom's presence because I remember every single day at 6 o'clock, I would go to the beach, lay down, and talk to my mom.
Yeah.
There was this specific star.
Yeah.
That was there. Because, you know, the skies over there in Bahia, it's crazy. So many stars. And I look at the same star every single day at 6 o'clock.
Beautiful.
And start talking to her. So she was always there with me.
Guiding.
So it's funny that you say that because, yeah, man, it's always been like a feminine energy around me that was guiding me.
Yeah.
You know, which make a lot of sense. Like,
of course.
If you believe in spirituality, you know.
That's right, my brother.
Like, it makes so much sense.
Yeah. There's no coincidences.
Yeah.
Mm.
Now I can hear you better.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay,
maybe. That's probably why I was screaming before I didn't realize.
Paulie, production meeting.
I can hear perfect now.
Well, you're probably just paying attention now.
Right? Yeah.
That's probably all it is. Brasileiro tá falando muito. No. Not
at all. Hey! Go!
That's the first one.
Yeah.
If you're lucky, you get a couple more. He's very tight with his applauses.
Oh, really?
Yeah. We'll see how we go.
I don't know what this
button
does.
Ah, you already had a go at that. DK copped that tonight. Yeah, I've had that a few times, of course.
This is cool. I like that.
Yeah. He's got the power now, you know. He's power hungry, you know. Yeah. More. Anyway. Brother, so, okay. So, London, bit of an interesting place, right? Because so big and so much happening, but also so ugly and whatever at the same time. That's what I hear because I've never been.
The first day that I went to London, I break down, man. I was like probably back then I was 18, over 18.
Yeah.
I turned 18, I think. I can't remember if it was in London or Portugal, but when I got to London, I went to bed and I woke up midday and it was 5 a.m. Everything was dark. I was like, what's going on here?
So you're winter.
Yeah, but then it was winter. Man, it was very depressing.
Yeah, man.
Like, I was like, oh my God. Again, coming from the islands.
Of course.
And I remember calling Lisa and say, oh, I feel like crying. Like, this is crazy.
Yeah.
It's 12 o'clock, everything's dark. And I called Sofia back in Portugal. And I was like, oh, come and get me out of here. This place is crazy. I remember, man, that was a really bad experience.
Yeah.
And the pollution on the streets from the bus.
Yeah.
Oh, I used to get sick a lot from
How long
pollution.
Were you there for?
In London for another year.
Ooh, yeah. Okay. So you lasted a while.
Yeah.
Working with the, you know, samba and performing and everything.
Yeah, I started to. Lisa found a lot of places. I work everywhere. I work in Notting Hill, in Liverpool.
Uh-huh.
I danced with this dance company. I got a job with this dance company. Ashebaba, the name of the dance company.
Okay.
And we travel everywhere.
Oh, nice.
Actually, we travel everywhere in Europe, not just in London.
Yeah,
cool. France, Italy, everywhere.
Awesome experiences, man. You've done it all, bro.
Yeah. I was so young as well, man.
Yeah. Just along for the ride.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I never accept the weather in London.
Oof.
Never. It's too crazy.
No, I hear that, man. My sister was telling me the same thing. She lived there for a while.
Yeah.
She goes, when the sun comes out, everyone walks around like saying hello to each other and like hugging each other because they're so happy that the sun's out.
Yeah. No, it is. And you see everyone topless on the bath.
Yeah.
You go on the bath. It's
18
like,
degrees.
Yeah.
It's like in the middle of winter, you go to Bondi and you see all those crazy Pommy basses bloody swimming and shit. And you go, what the hell? 18 degrees, 17 degrees, and they're in there like it's the middle of summer.
Yeah, I remember the coolest thing to do was when the sun comes out
and
you go to a swim pool. You know, like you find...
Yeah, that's right.
Like everyone was there.
Yeah.
Like, it was like being on the beach.
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah, because beach is not a thing there.
Mm. It was a cultural shock for me, for sure.
I can't imagine.
Yeah.
So how does Australia come into the picture?
Liz is Australian.
Sure.
So we went to London.
Yeah.
Live in London with Lisa. And then Lisa got pregnant.
Opa.
Yeah.
Okay.
And she would say, there is no way that I'm going to have my child away from my family.
Sure.
So that was another nightmare.
Big shock.
Yeah. Because then I have to, we were just boyfriend, girlfriend.
Yeah.
Then when...
how do you get to Australia?
Australia.
Very strict.
Is one of the hardest countries to get into.
That's right.
To get visa or, you know. And she was already pregnant. That was before we made the decision to come here.
Mm.
She got pregnant.
Yeah.
Like, okay, we're going to keep the baby. Like,
sure.
So I'm going to have to come with you. And anyway, I couldn't get it. Visa me.
No.
They wouldn't give it to me.
No.
So I have to go to Brazil with Lisa.
Yeah.
Which is like 8 hours flight.
Yeah, but pregnant and everything, right?
Yeah, but she got married. We got married.
In Brazil.
Shotgun ready.
Yep.
Like...
Papers.
And then, doing the papers, and I'm like, that's the only way that I'm going to go and be with my child.
Yeah.
And then we go back to London, and then this all happened like this in months.
Then do the paperwork from London.
Yeah. And I still couldn't get her. So she came, and I have to stay there for five months by myself.
In London?
In London. I got here just before she was having the baby.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So you made it?
Yeah, I did.
Was that to Sydney?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Beautiful.
Yeah.
So you arrived in Sydney a very young man.
Yeah, man. I was 19.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Oh, man, we can be here the whole night.
I'm
actually skipping a lot of things.
Oh, man. I'm sure so you are. And probably people at home will have to read the book.
That's right.
When the time comes... You know, we'll make sure that all the we'll update everything with all the links and everything, because I'm sure a lot of people want to read more into this story, as I do. And we've spoken over the years about that story, bits and pieces.
Yeah.
And I know myself, I'm very interested in having a room in a month or so when the time comes. But no, I there's one thing that I want to speak on, because there's usually a transition, you know, because nowadays, super established director of Rhythm Brazil, which is, you know, the most, again, renowned and by far number one Brazilian performance company in Australia. But you arrive into Sydney basically, you know, like a kid, no idea. Great dancer, great performer, I'm sure, but you know. Yeah. I'm sure if someone said to you, do you have an ABN, you would have said, no, I don't play basketball. I don't like the NBA.
Oh, man.
And you're English.
Oh, man. Oh, just before I came to Australia with Lisa, I had the worst experience. I live in this house in London.
Yeah.
Talk about English.
English, yeah.
I live in this house in London, and there was people from Australia, London, and New Zealand.
Oof.
The house was have like about 12 rooms.
Ah, okay.
But it was a big house.
Yeah, sure.
And every night, everybody goes down to the living room to eat the dinner, watch TV.
Yeah.
Every single night, man, for months, I was the only one that didn't understand nothing.
Shit.
I sit there angry. I wanted to kill everyone.
Yeah.
Because I'm
so like... How did Lisa speak to you?
Lisa actually speak very good Portuguese.
Portuguese?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Interesting.
She used to translate to me, you know, but after a while, you like...
No.
You're like, I don't want to do that anymore,
No, fuck no.
I have a really bad experience with this.
Oof, yeah.
One night, I remember that I said to Lisa, listen, I'm going back home. I can't do this anymore.
Yeah.
Because the English, like, When I got there from Portugal, I have no idea what English was.
Sure.
Like, not even, hello, how are you? Nah. Nothing. Nothing, man.
Yeah.
Then when Lisa left, it was even more tough, but I was actually good.
Yeah.
Because I forced myself. You
to. Yeah, yeah, correct. Uh-huh.
I live in this house with 15 people from everywhere English speaking country.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, like, if I have to learn.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I said to myself, okay, I'm gonna go to the Brazilian community to do the job, the shows. Yep. Then I'm gonna come here and I'm gonna force myself, because otherwise I'm gonna go to Australia. What about Lisa's mom and dad? How am I gonna, you know? Yeah. And I came here, I had nothing, man.
Yeah.
Nothing at all.
Yeah. Yeah, the older you are, the harder it is, you know. So, you know, not that 18, 19 is old, but a lot easier at, you know, 5, 6, 7, whatever. So you arrive into Sydney, and then what was that scene like? Because you would have had to plug into, again, to the Brazilian community, Brazilian shows, who wanted a young Timbalada to come and perform. And so what was that like? And I'm sure that's when Marconi also comes into the picture. No?
Yeah, actually, when I come here for the first year or two, I chose not to be in the industry.
Okay.
Because I knew what it's like to be in the industry.
Yeah.
I was like, I'm going to get distracted. I'm just about to have a child.
That's right.
If I'm going to go straight to the industry,
it's going to be trouble.
It's going to be trouble. Mm. I know I'm going to go there. I'm going to meet some Brazilian boys, people from the show, and I'm going to be all over the place.
Late nights.
Yeah. So for the first 2 years, I just took a break from shows. I just did all the Aussie stuff, like working construction.
Sure.
Doing whatever I could to survive.
Yeah.
And then on the meantime, I was making my connection, you know, with Marcia Pinheiro.
Marcia. Remember Marcia? Marcia Pinheiro, of course. Yeah. She was one of the players in the industry back then. Yeah. Dancing and everything. She was the founder of LDA?
Yeah.
Okay,
that's right.
Sure.
Yeah.
Marcia. Shout out to Marcia.
Yeah.
Marcia Pinheiro.
And then, you know, like, then I make my connection with Nego Coy,
Marconi, Coy. Beleza,
Nego Jorge.
Uh-huh.
And I was talking to the boys phone, but we never actually met.
Sure.
Then one day I went to a party, to a master's party at the Spanish club upstairs.
Sure.
Where
the old Spanish club, Liverpool Street. Yeah, level that's 2. Right. Yeah.
And I met Nego Jorge there.
Sure.
And George was like, oh, you from, you know, Baianos, when
of
they
course.
See Baianos, they're like, you're my family, come here.
Yeah.
You know, George got me in, he just said, okay, you with me now. Uh-huh. Like, okay, what can you do? I'm like, oh, man, what can I do?
Yeah. That's right.
And then he's like, okay, cool. So he brought me to, introduce me to Marconi, to Nego Coy, to everyone.
Yeah, shout out to all those boys, man. Yeah, Marconi, of course, Marconi Pereira. Negro Coy, another brother of mine, and Georgie, all good boys, very well known in the Brazilian community, and all of them spending a lot of time entertaining and carrying the torch, you know, for capoeira, for samba, for Brazilian culture, for Afro-Brazilian culture.
Yeah, man.
And along the way, having a lot of fun. And
those guys, you know, because partying you go to work with these guys a lot, man. You know. Yeah. The boys always tell me stories with you, even before me.
That's right.
When I tell George, I remember telling George, oh, I'm working with MC Rafa. He's like, oh, man, you are exactly the same like Rafa. Even George was telling me that. Like, oh, you guys are perfect together. Yeah.
Well, you know, when I went away, they were the Rhythm Brazil time.
Yeah.
They were the main guys, you know. And then obviously 7 years later, they were in a different part of their career. But then all you younger guys had come through. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
That's
so,
right.
So, yeah. So, yo.
Timbalada. When you met, did you hear any rumors about Rafa being a certain type of character? How did they describe him back then?
No, the boys always talk about La Familia.
What the fuck are you trying to get at? He's trying to set you up for something, man. I can smell it.
Nah, man, these guys, La Familia crew, which I never got to meet properly,
Just missed each other.
Yeah.
Just missed
like
each other.
Like a year or something.
Yeah.
And the boys were talking, oh, man, that was... Because I used to go to La Cita and Cruz, but the boys said, nah, but La Familia, Rafa. I hear about you way before even we met.
Yeah. We used to go pretty hard.
Used to talk.
Christina, because
we were working together.
Yeah. Yeah, those were great times, man. Yeah. La Familia days, yeah.
So George is pretty much, I met George and George said, okay, man, come with me. I'm going to introduce you to all the boys. Yeah. And that was it, man. And then...
Let me say something real quick. Listen, next time you want to set up one of my guests, you're going to get in trouble from me, all right? He's trying to say, what are you trying to set him up to say? I'm arrogant or what's the go? Huh? This motherfucker.
Yeah, well, did they say he was arrogant?
Bro, this is the thing, right? Guys, I'm down to, you know, I'm a showman.
No way, nah.
Man. No, but hold on. Let me finish on this, right? I'm a showman as much as anyone else. But obviously these people, like producing him and other people that I won't speak about, they're always trying to poke the fucking bear, you know, because they want, what do they want? They want shit that they can produce, you know, like sensationalized. Okay, so every now and then they try. So for the La Familia documentary, they were probing people, you know, one fucking big mouth motherfucking barramundi named Ruin Loquito Mas goes, yeah, he's fucking arrogant. He was arrogant. Everyone thought he was arrogant. Whoa, end of the world. These blokes' eyes lit up and they're, we're gonna go in. And they've been going in ever since. Anyway. Been fucking warned, bruh. Please, so the boys, you've connected now with the Baianos in Sydney.
Yeah, man.
Trouble's coming.
That was it, man.
Fucking
like hell. 1 year later, I was single. I knew it, man. I knew it, brother. That's why I was trying to.
That's right.
To distance. Stay. I think one. Oh, actually, no, I'm lying. It wasn't 1 year. Maybe 3 years after.
Okay.
I still hold myself there, but I was I want my freedom. I want my freedom, you know. Yeah. But I hang myself there as a dad for my daughter, and then I was like, okay, man.
That's it.
But I think that this is like when it's meant to be this way.
Yeah.
It's gonna be. It doesn't matter what you try. That's your journey.
Yeah.
You know.
Indeed. Yeah. I think it's an age thing too. I mean, I'm not saying that.
Oh, man, I was 20, 22.
Of course, brother.
22, course. 23.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. You're right about that.
It's very much an age thing, bro. It is. You're full of hormones, the decisions that you make. And you got to live, brother, both men and women. But, you know, maybe even more so men. I think there's like almost like even more adventurous type DNA in guys naturally or maybe culturally. I'm not saying it's right or wrong, but, you know, guys kind of need to, you know, roam more or whatever.
But with me, Rafa, is like, this is what I was thinking in my head. This is my excuse, which is a good excuse and it's real.
Yeah.
Because I always thought like, when I was 18, right? Or yeah, 18, almost 19.
Yeah.
Until I was 23, I was a little kid. And I was living this life of a dad.
Yeah.
You know, like I was kind of doing then what I'm supposed to be doing a little bit later on.
I get you.
So you get what I'm saying?
I get you.
I felt like that I missed out on all of this
time. I hear you, man. I hear you.
Yeah.
I was away for a long time. When I got out, you know, it was like catch up.
Yeah.
You know? I felt like, you know, my spirit needed to, you know, be free and adventurous and whatever. Beyond just women, you know, just the fact that you want to be independent and get up and go and travel and do things without having to think twice, you know. So, I mean, I'm sure the early days are doing lots of gigs for the other boys.
Yeah, I started to doing shows for Marcia, then Marconi, then Koi. Koi is like, when I met Koi, that's when everything happens.
Uh-huh.
Because Koi
was connected.
Yeah, Koi was like, and I learned a lot from him as a showman as well.
That's right.
I cannot say that because Koi have this energy when he's performing that is amazing.
Sure.
Like it's, especially back in the days, you know?
Of course.
And I was like with Koi everywhere he was going, I was there.
Yeah.
We were together like family, you know?
So you're soaking in a lot of his character.
Yeah.
Performing and everything.
Yeah, Koi, Marconi as well.
Marconi. Yeah, of course. Yeah, when I went away, you know, Marconi was the king. You know,
yeah.
That's why I always joke between us. I go that, you know, that you're the king now and, you know, he relinquished it. And of course, whenever he has a few drinks with me, he always says to me, nah, Timbalada. Shout out to my
Tony. No, but you know what's funny, man?
The Don.
These boys, they love that we were hooked up. They're working together.
Of course.
Everyone in the community.
Os from baianos.
Dance, no, not just me. Like the girls, Cristina, Leticia. Yeah.
Of course.
Everybody saw a connection in there when we started. First thing that we did was La Pegada.
Uh-huh.
Was it La Pegada?
Yeah. Well, as far as events, I think La Pegada, we did a... I remember that night, I was kind of in between events and stuff, and I said, Timba, why don't we do a party at 11, which is the old good bar?
Yeah.
And I remember they ran out of beer and everything. It was a fucking mess because, you know, we hit absolute capacity and everything. And we've done lots of bits and pieces. I want to get to those a little bit later.
Oh, okay.
But I want to know, how do you go from essentially drummer boy, dancer, you know, no disrespect, but a young man to the, you know, director of Rhythm Brazil, which is a big leap.
Okay. So I started to perform for Koi, for Marconi.
Yeah.
This is actually very interesting. And, I saw that all the old school boys were kind of dying.
Uh-huh.
Kind of like I am now.
Generational, yeah.
Yeah, kind of like how I am right now. I'm like, I'm still doing show, but not as excited as I used to be.
Time to pass the baton.
Yeah, that's right, you know.
To the new generation.
Yeah, so I felt like the older boys were like, I don't really want to do a show today, man. I was like, right, something's missing.
Yeah.
Something needs to be done.
Spark. Yeah.
Yeah. And then I was like, you know, back on the days, I used to have like 12 back. Uh-huh. Like train a lot and have this really good body.
Mm.
And a few of the boys that was the new generation also have the same look.
That's right.
And I was like, okay, how about this?
Mm.
What if we...
do our own thing.
Do our own thing.
Mm.
And now we're going to do shirtless. I started with Claudio Cartagena.
Yeah, shout out to Claudio, man. Yeah, my man.
Yeah, I did with me and Claudio. There was another boy, Felipe. He's a capoeira boy from... you know, he's kind of look like you, but he's just bigger.
Sure.
You know him. He's from back in the days as well.
Yeah, probably, man.
Me and Felipe, Claudio.
Yeah.
And Mestre Formiguinha.
Formiguinha. As well, shout out to Formiguinha, man. Respect.
Yeah. And we say, oh, man, let's do these gigs shirtless. Just show the body. Because before...
they didn't do it.
No. They, did the capoeira.
Sure.
With capoeira show with the shirtless.
Sure.
But the batucada, everything, they have a costume.
Ah, okay.
So pretty much me and Claudio come up with this idea of doing a shirtless batucada.
You're right.
And man, went off.
Of course.
Like, you know, everywhere we perform, people are like, oh, I want this, you guys again with the shirtless.
Mm.
You know, and then slowly, I started to get a few calls, a phone call from someone. Someone, hey, you're doing show. I'm like,
your own gigs.
Yeah.
Mm.
I was like, oh, I don't really do a show, but if you want, you know, and Claudio was in the background, no, we can't do it. Let's do it together.
Uh-huh.
So we start to rehearse our own batucada, create our own style.
Sure.
And we always, me and Claudio, would go to the beach, sit on the beach, like, okay, let's design something different.
Mm.
Let's get away a little bit from this very traditional show.
Yeah.
We still give the girls.
Of course.
But we give better drums. And
better more boys, sexiness. Yeah. So more focus on the guys and the drums, yeah.
That's right.
Than just the feathers.
That's right.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay. So now you got something for the boys and for the ladies.
For the ladies as well. Yeah.
And man, it's starting to go off slowly. And me, being a business mind, I always have.
Yeah.
I always see opportunities in everything.
Yeah.
And that's when I start date Claudia. Gutierrez.
Sure, yeah. Claudia, yeah. Shout out to Claudia. The
mother of my son.
Yeah.
Which she was also a samba dancer.
Sure.
And we start to, like, date.
Sure.
And somehow we move in together very quickly.
Yeah.
You know, I was like, okay, look, let's put a group together.
Mm.
I look after the boys.
Yeah.
You look after the girls.
Makes sense, yeah.
You know, and we start with a company we call Brazilian Roots.
Okay.
That's how we start.
Yeah, that's your old Facebook name.
That's right. Yeah.
Brazilian Roots, yeah.
I actually forgot about that name, but it's true.
That's when I met you. You on Facebook, you're Brazilian Roots. Okay.
So we start, me and Claudio put Brazilian Roots together.
Yeah.
Claudio, we doing with
The women.
With the women, I deal with the boys.
Sure.
And I have a crowd on the background help me
yeah.
as well. And man, it went off. It went off, man. Everybody yeah. now starts to calling Brazilian Roots.
Sure.
You know, everyone starts to like, oh, I want the show, but I want the boys with shirtless.
Yeah.
Can someone come doing the show, but I don't want the boys on t-shirts. Can you, you know?
It's got to be topless.
Man.
Yeah.
Then before I knew, I have so many boys.
Yeah.
Good looking boys with yeah. good body want yeah. to be part of the group.
Sure.
So we have to pick a few. Mm. Like whoever was more...
Yeah.
Osado, like...
Yeah.
How to say Osado more... Like
focus, hard working, yeah. interested. Yeah.
yeah. and we kind of went off, man. Yeah. And Brazilian Roots took off for... Before I knew, I was actually calling Marconi and the shows for me.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, but always respected the boys.
Oh, no, of course, of course.
Like, you know, yeah, like yeah, yeah. Yeah. always give them the credits.
Of course.
Like...
Yeah, man, it's your predecessor. You know, that's the previous generation that came before you. You know, they opened the door, and I think we all have that in some way, shape, or form. And then we have a transition to what you have today, which is Rhythm Brazil.
Yeah. So when everything has a beginning and an end.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, a few years later.
Yeah.
Me and Claudio broke up.
Sure.
And me and Claudio broke up. I keep Brazilian Roots for another year by myself, you know. Mm. I just book the girls myself, or yeah. sometimes it's called Claudio, can you help me?
Sure.
Like, even though we still work together for a year.
Yeah.
Like, it was a disaster, but we managed to do.
Sure.
And then yeah. after that, we broke up for real. And... We didn't want to work with each other anymore because it's too much fights and stuff like that. Yeah. And that's when Sasha sure. actually was also have a group that called Melange with Mina.
Okay.
And Mina moved to Cuba.
You both left partnerless yeah. in the business. And it made sense to join forces.
Yeah, because even before we joined forces,
yeah,
he
was still kind of working together.
Yeah, because yeah. Sasha would call me yeah, for the boys.
Dances. Yeah, yeah,
and
that's right.
I would call her for, and for then the one day yeah, yeah. we were like, hey, let's.
It made sense. Yeah, yeah, it was organic.
Yeah, let's get together. Let's make one group. Mina's gold. You sure. know, with Cloud anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's
yeah.
just make one. Yeah. Forget about my lunch. Forget about Brazilian Roots.
Yeah, we'll come let's up with a new one. Name. Yeah, yeah.
Sasha coming to my house. We have dinner.
And Rhythm Brazil was
and
born.
And Rhythm Brazil was born.
Ah, man. Yeah, epic, man. Bro. That's a good a symbiotic relationship. You and Sasha at the time, you know, I think it was a great combination. And it was the beginning of a big run because Rhythm Brazil, you know, has been around and established yeah. for a very long time. You guys have done a lot of things. We've got some photos in show and tell that we'll speak about soon.
Okay.
I can hear you a lot louder now.
Oh. Hello. Sorry, man.
Hello, Timbalada.
Hey.
But I know what I was going to say is because you guys have done, I mean, as far as a Brazilian performance company, as far as any dance company, even in Australia, you guys have, you know, top yeah. of the tree, you know, from you know, with the Olympic team, biggest stages in Australia, festivals, Mardi Gras, everything. And we'll talk a little bit about later because we've got some awesome yeah. images to show.
Okay, cool.
The one thing, now we can really hear, Pauly. You got a sexy voice now, Timbalada.
Oh, thanks, man.
Beleza. Hey, what I wanted to say is samba. Now, some time ago, we were talking about putting together this big samba project, which may still happen one day.
Oh, man, it's still on my
yeah, it's on drawing. The radar. It's on the drawing board. I think it's definitely worth pursuing, and I'm not going to talk about it.
On camera. But I was thinking about the other day.
Yep. But you just don't call me. Anyway.
when the time is right, it's going to come to life, man.
No, it's all good. I know. I feel the same way. Coração. But I remember speaking to you and saying, everyone in the world knows samba.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Brazil, the feathers, carnaval, whatever. But no one knows samba.
Yeah.
You know, like, of course, there's a history to it. There's the instruments. There's all the different origin points, because you know you've got samba from all the, even within Rio, you've got all these different suburbs that have it. And we don't know, like, you know, as of when I put my gringo hat on, I say, well, name me one samba person.
Yeah.
You know, like a Neymar of football, or, you know, or a Gaetano with Bossa Nova, whatever. I don't, when I think of samba, I don't, you know, I don't know much more than the average person. Tell us about samba. Tell us about the instruments, its history, where it comes from, and just the general picture of samba, por favor.
Samba is actually coming from Bahia. Sure. Again, coming from the...
Yep, slaves.
Slaves, and was born in Bahia, and then they have this type of samba in Bahia. Then to make short and quick, otherwise you're going to be here the whole night.
It's okay, man.
Then went to Rio.
Sure.
Like, and that's when took over the world.
Sure.
You know, like in Bahia, we still that traditional samba.
More Afro.
Afro, more with the hands, chachado, all these different types of samba.
Sure. Less refined,
man. Yeah. Then when you got to Rio, the cariocas, you know, they make it their own, you know, and that's pretty much how it took over.
So what time frame are we talking about? Like 1900s? Early 1900s?
Yeah, around there.
1900s, after Bossa Nova?
Oh, man.
Around the same time? It's a good
question. Now you're making me think, man, I got a headache now.
I mean, because am I safe to say that because samba, essentially all the instruments are European?
Yeah, I know we were talking about this before, but again, it's all connected with capoeira, candomblé.
Sure.
Because all these European, I saved this for the interview, for the actually. All these European instruments, this is all come after.
Yeah.
It's what we call Americanizado.
Yeah.
You know?
Yep.
But before that's
modern day. Yeah.
Before that, there was no snare drum, man.
Yeah.
There was no hepinique. There was no the boom boom.
Yeah.
You know, so it's nowadays you can say that, but back on the days was hands.
That's right.
Was a piece of wood with the cow skin.
Sure.
That you make the noise.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's how.
No doubt about it.
Yeah.
Originally, it would have been 100%.
Yeah.
Everywhere in Latin America.
That's right.
The origins of any sort of Afro sound would have more than likely been cow skin and know, wood and
And if you look on Escola de Samba, like years and years ago, you look at the instruments, that's how they play.
They look real African. Okay, cool. So it's quite a modern thing. Samba.
Nowadays, what you see nowadays, that's right.
The final format, let's call it.
If you go back to Bahia, it's completely different.
Roots.
You know, it's a completely different roots. Yeah, it's more roots. You know, you see these old ladies dance with the finger of the feet, you know, it's beautiful, man.
Yeah.
It's like you can't describe the feeling.
Do you, in the parades in Salvador do Bahia, do you have the old man and the old woman represented in the parade?
Because it's different though.
Oh, okay.
Because in Bahia we don't do the samba, this feeling.
Ah, okay, you do the block.
We do the it was bloco.
Yeah, bloco.
Bloco. Which is more like axé.
Okay.
It's different type of
show.
Of shows.
So Rio then has taken samba, the original samba roots from Bahia, and kind of made it its own. And they're very Hollywood, because obviously, you know, then the Sambódromo came, and Carnaval and the competition, and you know, it's like the World Cup of partying in the world, you know.
Yeah.
The modern day samba drum line includes the surdo.
Yeah, there's so many different instruments, man.
Yeah, the surdo is the big one.
Yeah, the surdo,
big bass drum. Yeah,
the bass drums.
Yeah,
then we've got the snare drum.
Sure.
We've got the hepiki, hepinique, which is the lead drum.
That's right.
Which is the one that I play.
That's right. Well, you can play them all, but
I can play them all.
And that's the smallest one and the highest pitch sound.
That's right. Yeah. Then you've got the tamborim,
sure,
the pandeiro, yeah, cuica,
yeah, the cuica,
even the cavaquinho,
yeah, cavaquinhos, yeah, when they start singing and yeah and performing, yeah, yeah,
and
yeah,
now they have the timbal.
Uh-huh. They, so they timbal, throw the timbal, yeah, back from the,
yeah,
roots.
That's, yeah, right. In, yeah, a sense, it is. Uh-huh. Yeah,
that's awesome.
Yeah,
and then obviously the dance is a huge part of it.
Yeah,
and I'm sure again it was the cariocas that kind of really, yeah, refined the whole, is, thing. Yeah, because it's yeah, a big part of kind of, oh, is that competition between all the female, yeah, dancers as well.
Yeah.
And the corries and the costumes. And for people at home that don't know, Carnaval is a competition.
Yeah, it is.
All the Escola de Sambas from Rio,
yeah,
go once a year to compete.
Yeah.
And there's like lyrics.
Yeah.
There's prizes for the, yeah, best song.
Yeah.
Which obviously has got the lyrics and everything. And every year, each Escola de Samba picks a topic.
Yeah, that's right.
It could be big things like slavery, or could, yeah, be like Trump. Could, yeah, be anything.
Yeah,
and they all kind of make their presentation based, yeah, around that. So, yeah, then that tells the colors and everything.
Yeah,
and then they got prizes for the best dancer, which is like the queen, yeah, of the carnival, right?
Yeah, she ends up. You have the passistas, yep, then you've got the queen.
Yeah,
the king.
But first, you got to be the queen of your area.
That's right.
Yeah. So there's like an inner competition first.
Yeah.
They decide who the queen is.
Yeah.
And then
you become the queen of that school.
Of that school.
Yeah.
Which represents an area, a, yeah, suburb.
But now you also have the queen of the
whole carnival.
The whole carnival.
Yeah. So then you go to carnival. Yeah, and then they pick. So it's a big serious, yeah, thing. I know in Uruguay, our you know, we're a much smaller country, but it again, it's a thing that runs for weeks and they all compete, you know,
yep,
for prizes and everything. So super interesting. The same
they compete in Uruguay.
Yeah,
as well,
man. Uruguay, serious. It goes for a month. Wow. Goes for a month, which people say is the longest in the world. May not be true. Yeah, it goes for a month and they compete. And then every year, obviously, there's a whole bunch of prizes because Carnaval for us, everyone knows Candombe, I'm sure, yeah, you do, which, yeah, also comes from West Africa. But then, yeah, there's all these other art forms. Murga and Parodistas and all these other areas that they also compete for in the whole month of February. Serious business.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Especially in Brazil.
Oof.
Like, so, if you talk about business, so, yeah, much money.
A lot of money,
like,
involved.
The bicheiro, you know, the bicheiro?
Yeah.
The guys that run the illegal games, okay, gambling, they're the ones that run the carnival.
Oh, really?
And the drug dealers as well, man.
Yeah, I'm
they
sure.
Pretty much put all the money. And without them, there's no carnival.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, they control that. Well, it's very much from those suburbs, you know, yeah, so it's always going to be linked to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you run that area.
That's right. Then you got a big say.
Yeah. You got to put the money for, because it's good for you as well. Like,
of course.
You put this much money, then you get five times more.
And,
yeah.
Yeah. And
yeah.
Yeah. So it's a business, but also there's a community vibe to it as well, obviously, because all,
right,
those people coming together, they make all the dresses and the, you know, and the decorations and everything. So that's an experience I'd love to live one day. I've always wanted to do it. It's on my to-do list, man. And you know, the people that have gone have all said the same things. So
yeah,
fucking amazing.
So yeah,
yeah.
Personally, I would say yes, go, because it's like it's a good experience. But if you wanted to have some real fun,
yeah,
you gotta go to Bahia for carnival.
Oh no, when I say, yeah, go, I mean go to Bahia, yeah, as well, not only Rio. Yeah. Rio very much I think would be cool because, you know,
it's like watch a big show, you sit down, course, and you watch.
Yeah, that's right.
In Bahia you actually go and you're in the middle of the people,
yeah,
and you dance. It's, yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah. I mean even it would be amazing to see the rehearsals, like ensayos and all, yeah, that in the, yeah, in the areas. And so we'll put that on the to-do list one,
yeah,
day,
man.
Brother. God willing, man, we'll be able to get over there and travel around, and you can show me those people, and I can practice my 50 words of Portuguese. But muita gente no mundo está falando que eu falo
português.
De português bem.
Fala bem.
Eu sempre falo que tem muitos amigos brasileiros em, yeah, Sydney. Eu sempre penso em você.
Não, você fala muito bem.
Obrigado, irmão. Não, porque o ano passado, não, o outro, eu estive em Portugal também. A gente fala, você fala brasileiro. Like, I'm from Australia.
No, it's funny.
Go, Não, você não fala português, você fala brasileiro.
It's funny because when we do the carnival, the party,
yeah,
right? And something happened and somebody come to talk to me and like, oh yeah, but o Rafa falou, like Rafa say this, Rafa, não, Rafa de que parte do Brasil? Where is Rafa from? I'm like, Rafa is not Brazilian, Rafa is Uruguay. Oh, I knew that.
I knew that. You can tell by the way
I told he was Brazilian that was born here.
Yeah.
And so many times people told me this, man.
Yeah. I try and get away
because
with
it. Because you talk to them in Portuguese. Yeah. And then some of them will come to me and say, oh, yeah. I have no idea that he was a Brazilian.
You know, a lot of the times I rattle off my Portuguese and it's good enough to convince them. So then they go, but and I can kind of pick up like every fourth word. And it takes me like 3 seconds to process, you know. So then I respond.
I remember a story now. Yeah. I don't know if you're gonna remember this. I think was at what's the nightclub in the Star City that we did the part.
Marquee. Yeah.
I don't know if it was Marquee or I can't remember, but do you remember the Brazilian girl called Camila?
La Morena, yeah, Camila Bonita, Pilosca. Yeah, Pilosca. Shout out to Camila. Yeah.
I remember one day we went to Camila was with me and you were
story.
Talking to her.
Yeah.
No, but I think, yeah. I don't know if this one or something else that you know, but she told me, because you talked to her in Portuguese and we were in a club and she go, I don't know, this Brazilian guy is all over me, but I don't really like these white Brazilian boys because they think that we are whatever. I'm like, Camila, Rafa is not Brazilian. She was going, what do you mean?
Yeah.
This is long time ago, man. And your Portuguese now is way better.
I must have been that drunk that it was sounding good, but
I remember.
Yeah.
She was like, I don't know a Brazilian. I'm like, no, he's not Brazilian.
Well, I'll tell you a funny story with a beautiful Camila, man, because she chewed my head off.
I remember something.
Yeah, because... So we're having dinner at a sushi place, and you know, she's a beautiful Brazilian girl, and I'm talking away, blah blah blah. And we kind of switched to Spanish a little bit, again, because a lot of Brazilian people can pick up bits and pieces of Spanish, and I have as much fun, I think, listening to Brazilians speak Brazilian as some Brazilians listening to us speak Spanish, particularly from Uruguay, Argentina. Anyway, so she was laughing along. But then I said, brah, 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 un macaco.
Oh, yeah, you told me that.
Okay, cool. Now let me explain. Un macaco in Uruguay is like, this is a macaco.
Yeah.
Un macaco, like a toy. Actually, that's a macaco. Un macaco, you know, is a toy, like a toy figure, right? And she looked at me. She goes, what did you say? I said, macaco. You can't say that. That's rude. That's so rude. And I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about? Macaco. Anyway, macaco is a type of monkey.
Yeah.
Right? And in Brazil, it's very derogatory towards a black person.
That's right.
To say monkey.
Yeah.
And I
macaco.
Remember.
Macaco. When you call someone macaco, it's like, whoa.
And that was like the end.
Yeah, I remember.
Right? It was like, okay, I got to go, bye. It's like, fuck. So obviously very, you know, Camila very, you know, sort of, who knows. Who knows, maybe she's had some tough run-ins with racism and stuff. But anyway, funny story, man.
Fucked up. I have a question.
Tell me, brother.
Last year, we did a thing at Bondi?
The promo run? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but was there a time you guys got in trouble that, we're going to have a potential barbecue?
Oh. Right. So you and I have run some pretty fucking big and awesome events, including Brazilian Carnival. The poster which, when we leave, I've got the poster up in the reception.
Oh,
room.
Yeah.
Have a look. So, you know, we've done once a year, we've ran Carnival in Brazilian Carnival in Sydney for many years.
Yeah.
Beginning at Ivy. Then we've done Hard Rock Cafe. We've brought over Carlinho Salgueiro from Brazil, and we've done some awesome events and things. But a couple of years ago, we organized as we do. We like doing the pre parties on the beaches.
Yeah.
And so on Facebook and social media, we launched the pre-party on the beach in Coogee, and then the official carnival was the following Sunday in one of the venues we were working with. The Facebook social media event of the Brazilian pre-party took off like, I don't know,
50,000 people or something.
It was like crazy, and everyone's like, man, you know. And then, so we get an inbox from Maruba police.
Yeah.
You know, what the fuck, you know? Later on, I found out through the industry that it was our competitor who actually rang the police.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, you know, officially verified. I think we had that conversation.
Yeah.
God bless him anyway, whatever. But it was a shame because that thing would have been a monster.
Yeah.
We had to shut it down because it's just took on its own whatever. It was a monster. But we've definitely done some cool things. And speaking of Coogee and Bondi Beach, there was a very sad tragedy a few years ago, which a lot of people heard of. And I know it's very close to home for you because he was one of your brothers. I remember meeting the guy, full of life. As many of, you know, your people around you have always been, which, you know, big heart and performers and all these things. Now, the brother Leandro Santos.
Yeah.
So he was doing backflips or diving into the water from the rocks in North Bondi. Yeah?
No, actually.
So how was the story, please?
Okay, so the story was... was a Saturday. I'm gonna give you the story from the beginning. Like,
please, man. Yeah.
Was a Saturday morning. It was a beautiful Saturday morning.
Yeah.
You know, and we have a tradition that every Saturday we go to the gym.
Sure.
And we train to look good for the show at night.
Of course.
And this day we woke up like and I call him. I say, Leo, I'm gonna pick you up. We're going to the gym. Yeah. He said, no, let's not go to the gym. Let's go to the beach because we can do a workout on the beach rather than go to the gym. And then we can go for a swim after.
Yeah.
So anyway, went to his house, picked him up, and we went to the Bondi, the baths.
Yep.
And we start training, and we've been there for like an hour and a half, man. And I was like, Leo, it's let's go, man. We've been training for so long, like,
finish.
Fuck, we finish.
Yeah.
He go, no, I'm hungry. I want to do more. It's so crazy, man. I remember that day. So crazy because I keep pushing him to go.
Mm.
I say, no, I need to train a little bit more. I was like, oh, this guy's weird, you know? Anyway, finally I managed to get him to finish. We put our sungas on and we went down to the beach. And as we walk through Bondi Beach, I say to him, like, I always play around, you know me. I start to walk like I was
disabled.
Sure. He was like, he looked at me like, Timba, don't do that. Never doing that. Never play like that.
Mm.
And I was like, whoa, coming from Leo, such a sweet guy who never raised his voice or anything. I thought that I was weird.
Mm.
He said, no, never doing that. I mean, imagine if that was you. Like, I was like, hey, but hold on, man. I'm just joking. Like, chill. He was like, oh, no, it's all good. All right. Then we walk, another 100 meters. He looked at me. He go, Timba, is it me or there's a really weird energy in the air? And I said to him, why you say that? He's go, I don't know, man. I just feel this really weird energy. I'm like, what are you talking about, man? It's a beautiful day. Yeah. Just have the best workout. And look at everyone. Look at us. Like, we, you know.
Looking good. Hot, feeling good. Know? Yeah, yeah.
He go, no, Timba, there's something there. Oof. That was 100 meters, man, before we stopped. And then we were walking. And there was crowd energy. We was there with us, Sasha. And Lucas, a few other people, Daniel, you know, Daniel. And anyway, we say, oh, let's stop here. Let's go for a swim. Anyway, we put our phone on the beach, on the towel, put everything there. And then me, Daniel, Leandro, and João. I don't know if you remember João.
Yeah.
He's one of them as well. He went back to Brazil.
Yeah.
We went for swim. We wasn't doing flip. We wasn't running or anything. We just went normal. Just walked to the beach, walked to the water, swim. We all got up. I mean, me, Daniel, and João got up and start walking back. And then we look at each other. Where's Leo? We realized that Leo was still there on the water. And then João say to me, man, that's weird. Who's going to be under the water for that long?
Mm.
He never came up yet. And then João went back and said, Leo, are you okay? And he didn't reply. And he said, Leo. And then he pushed him. He was like, almost out of breath, which like if he was there for like 10 more seconds, he'll probably be dead.
Mm.
And I can hear João screaming, Timba, come back. Like something happened. And then he couldn't move. He couldn't move. The way that he hits his head on the bank of sand, he stayed right there. He couldn't move anymore. He was just like this floating on water.
So because of this accident,
mm-hmm.
Leo became a quadriplegic.
That's right.
And this story is amplified or more famous because of Bondi Rescue.
That's right. Yes. So
it ended up being on Bondi Rescue and obviously
all over the news.
All over the news as well, because you know it's not every day that someone has a swimming accident in Bondi and walks out or gets carried out a quadriplegic.
Yeah.
Tragic story. All over the news, and you were saying that because Bondi Rescue gets a lot of reruns, you know, it's like a moment that you have to relive over and over.
And then you
guys carried him out of the water.
Yeah, we carried him out of the water.
Yeah.
And put him on the floor, and he was talking to me, what happened? He said, I don't know, I just hit my head on the sand.
Wow.
And anyway, by that point, I think the surf lifesaver, I think they knew what happened because apparently it happens a lot around Bondi. Not a lot, but...
It can happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he say, whatever you do, tell him not to move.
Mm.
Stay the way that he is.
That's right.
And then he was explaining to me, I think he's broke his neck. Mm. And then, I start to... And you know, Leo, he was a big boy.
Yeah.
Like really big guy, like massive.
I think that's what made his story even more famous.
Yeah, that's right.
Because, you know, of course, Brazilian guy in Bondi, you know, tourist is always a thing because, you know, it's going to go to that country as well, wherever the person's from. But obviously, he was also a fine specimen of a man, you know. He was built super buff and ripped and lean and... We've got some photos of him. We'll show a little bit later, but and then that horrible feeling minutes before, obviously was some sort of.
Oh, he
omen.
Knew me.
Yeah.
When we were on a bar training, he knew. Do you know why? Because I remember talking to him after. Mm. I said to him, "Man, you were training like you knew that you're never gonna train again."
Wow.
And I have this conversation with him, and. We're talking about somebody who was hungry, obsessed with training.
Yeah.
Like I was like, I never saw anyone train for that long and not stopping.
Yeah.
And I remember being in the hospital with him after he was better, talking to him like, hey man, you knew it. He goes like, yeah, I knew it. You knew something like this was going to happen because the way that you were training was crazy.
Yeah. And where's the brother now?
He's home, man. He's in Bahia, in Brazil.
Sure.
He's with lucky that he's coming from a family that actually they are well, comfortable.
Can look after
financially him. Well. Like they have a nurse. If that happened to me, man, and I have to go back home, I don't know. I probably would ask for them to kill me because I wouldn't have anyone to spend that much money.
But what a sentence that is, man, you know, because being quadriplegic, you know, the mind still works. And the body's completely shut down from the neck down. That's such a cross to bear, you know, to carry for the rest of your life. Big shout out to Leo, man, and big shout out to his family. And, you know, what a crazy experience for you as well.
Oh yeah.
You know, I have a similar story, but I was with my dad in the water in Coogee, and help, and he's always joking around and shit. I'm like, all right, whatever. Help. So anyway, I pulled him out and he couldn't move.
Oh, your dad's. Wow.
Yes, but get this. So as we sort of make our way out into the sand, he was talking about feeling tingles coming from his neck and down into his arms and like burning. And I'm like, man, this is all the wrong. Because when I actually grabbed him out of the water, he was sideways like this. He couldn't move at all. Sort of just floating there, and I could see in his face he was worried. He's okay. We were worried for a little bit, but the funny thing is, what makes this story funny versus what happened to poor Leo is my dad had some back pain for most of his life, and after this thing, he had no more back pain.
Oh, wow. Thank God, man.
Only happens to my old man. He hit the sand head first so hard that he felt his whole back backbone go like that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, like crack.
Is it recently or
in Coogee? Yeah, like two, 3 years ago. Oh, wow. Yeah, yeah. So tourists, beware when you come to Australia.
Yeah, man.
You know, we've got some crazy tides and things here, and that's why I think Bondi Rescue has so much material
to put especially on the show. Especially in Bondi, man.
Yeah, like, Bondi in particular. Yeah.
You know how the beach is like underwater.
Yeah. And the rips.
So like this.
Yeah. In Australia, we've got 1,000 things that can kill you.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's crazy.
Like coming to Australia.
Like a little spider.
I'm going back home, man.
And another thing I know that's a big part of your life is faith. Describe your faith to us, man, because I know you, it's probably a mixture of things, no?
Faith, like... you mean about in life or?
Yeah, your faith. No, your faith, your own religion, because I know that you practice, you meditate, and you're a man of God in many ways.
Yeah, man.
But I also know, not only from knowing you, but from knowing Brazilians and Latin Americans, that it's like a mixture of things, you know, like Candomblé, Santeria, Catholicism, and even Buddhism, meditation, Eastern stuff.
Yeah.
Tell us a bit about that.
For me, it's like, I was going to say in Portuguese, em primeiro lugar. First of all, of course, the number one faith is it's God.
Mm.
You know, like, I'm definitely a man of God.
Yes, you are.
Like, I believe in God. I know that, I mean, I don't believe in God as a person, but I believe in God as energy, you know.
Sure.
And I'm a mix, man. Like, when it comes to religion, I'm taking a little bit of everything, whatever serves me.
That's right.
I'm like, okay, I agree with this. I take this with me.
What resonates?
Yeah. Mm. So I pretty much, I build for everything.
Yeah. Meditation?
Meditation. Oh, man. Meditation is like, woo, the best, man.
Sure.
Like, it's funny because nowadays, I've been going through a massive transition in my life right now as we're speaking.
Sure.
And it's the most emotional that I ever been in my entire life.
Sure.
Reason why also is because I'm writing my book and a lot of things coming up.
Of course.
That I left behind from my childhood. Mm. So, of course, I mean, I'm not ashamed to say that I have a lot of childhood trauma.
Yeah.
You know, especially coming from where...
Justifiably so, man. Yeah.
You know?
No doubt.
And it's like meditation is the only thing that get me back to me.
Yes.
You know? Like sometimes I might be lost and have some anxiety. And from the moment I close my eyes and let it go, I'm back to me again. So meditation is... It's definitely, it should be my priority right now, every single day.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, we can't do it every single day, but I do as much as I can. So
yeah.
I love it. Meditation, love it.
Yeah. It's a bit of work, isn't it, to shut off the mind and go to where you should be, you know, not where you are.
Yeah, I mean,
mind is a tough muscle to train, even though it's not a muscle, but you got to train it, right?
Yeah, but you know what's funny? It's funny because a lot of people tell me, oh, you know, my girlfriend, for example, she tells me, I can't meditate. I'm like, I have to say the same thing as you. Yeah. I have to say I can't. But the more you try, is the more that will come to you.
Yeah.
And she asked me, how did you know that you were meditating? I'm like, I don't even know.
Yeah. That's the whole point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All that I remember is every day I dedicate 5 to 10 minutes when I start. And closing my eyes, and then before I knew, I found myself, I remember, man, the first time.
Completely away.
Fly over this landscape of rose.
Yeah.
And that was such an amazing feeling. I'm like, I don't know how I got there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, for a lot of people, I think trying to, in today's world with, you know, iPhones and all these things, yeah, I think that would be, it'll be the same as, you know, start walking and you know, go to the Sahara from here, right? It's like a mission impossible. But I think you're right. It's like a step-by-step thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's funny, Rafa, because it's like I have a lot of friends and that want to meditate, to learn how to meditate.
Yeah.
And I tell them, once you master how to let go and of the thoughts, you trust me, it's addictive.
Yeah,
you're gonna want to do it all the time.
Yeah,
and after, when you open your eyes, and you just feel like you zen, nothing can bother you.
So many
times I went to do a meditation, I feel like angry, and when I meditate and then I finish up, I'm like, if that person that was angry was in front of me, I would probably kiss it.
Yeah.
Then I'll hug them.
Yeah, well, I think that's how we are in our true state.
Yeah.
And everything else is just the corruption of our true selves. You know, and that's why in the shaman world, in the shamanic world that I move in, the saying is, unbecome who we are not.
Yeah.
Not become who you are, because you already are that person. You just need to unbecome.
Yeah.
Who you are not.
That is really hard, man, because I tried to do that. You know, I went to doing the 10 days silent meditation.
Oh, Vipassana.
Vipassana.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if... Did I tell you this story what happened here?
I think we spoke about it, but please tell.
I went to doing the Vipassana, and man, it was the most crazy experience I ever had as well.
Yeah.
It's like you get in, and from the minutes that you walk in...
In the Blue Mountains of Sydney.
Yeah.
Yep.
The minutes you walk in, they tell you whatever you do, you're not allowed to look anyone in the eye.
Mm.
Like, they take everything, your phone, pen, whatever. You can't have contact with nothing books, except...
No writing.
Nothing.
Yep.
You have to focus on yourself and that's it.
Sure. Journey within.
Yeah, so for me, it was really hard, man, because...
And you can't speak.
No, yes, you can't speak. I have to sit in front of you and I can't look at you.
Sure.
Actually, I have to be in a room, sleep with you in the same room, and I have to wake up, you be in front of me, I can't look at you.
Mm.
You know, it was...
And not a word is spoken the entire time.
Nothing.
That's right.
For the 10 days.
Yeah.
So what happened to me was, the first day was cool, second day... was excited, like, but I was starting to like, uncomfortable, you know, especially because you have to wake up 4:30 every morning and you only have 2 meals a day.
Sure.
I don't know if you did, but.
No, I've never done Vipassana. No.
Yeah.
But I know a bit about it. Yeah.
You have the first meal at 6 or 7 a.m. after the 4:30 meditation, an hour and a half meditation. Then the second meal at 11 o'clock and all vegan as well.
Yeah.
So it's like it's only 2 meals.
Yeah.
So the second day was, you know, starting to question why am I here?
Mm.
The third day I was like, oh, okay, this is hard. You have to meditate 8 hours a day.
You're going to be sitting down a lot in awkward positions. Yeah. It feels quite awkward, no? Because you're on the ground. You're just on the ground. You're not like...
Yeah. That's why they make you... That's feel
right.
the pain.
That's right.
So because it's part of the...
That's right.
Whatever you're doing, the process, you know. Yeah. So I made it to 5 days. Why? Because on the fifth day at 4:30 a.m., I started to go crazy. I wasn't crazy. Like, it's not crazy.
No,
it's beautiful. But I didn't understand. And I started to get scared. I woke up in the morning, 4:30 a.m., and I walked past a tree, looking at the tree, good morning, brother. I say to the tree, good morning, brother. Good morning, brother. I was like, wow. Then I checked myself. I was like, hold on. I just talked to the tree.
Yeah.
Because I didn't say like as a joke. I was serious.
Yeah, I get
you. If I look at you, say, yeah, morning, Rafa.
Mm.
I look at the tree, morning, brother.
You connected.
Yeah. Mm. I was like, and then I was like, okay, this a lot of things start to happen. I started to question everything. I started to feel everything in my body. And I got scared. So I went to the monk and I said to him, look, I don't want to be here anymore. He goes, no, but this is normal. This is the fifth day. This is when you started to feel. I'm like, yeah, but I don't think I'm ready to know what that's I'm going to know.
Side. Yeah. Yeah.
He goes to me, are you sure about this? I said to him, yeah, I'm in the entertainment industry. Mm. Everything that I'm doing right now is against everything that I'm about to learn. I mean, it's not against, but it doesn't go together.
Yeah, that's right.
And
yeah.
I'm not ready to let go of that. So I said to him, I have to let go today.
Come back.
He go, what do you think? I think it's amazing. It's a life changing.
Yeah.
But I feel like I'm not ready. So I asked to leave.
And thinking of going back?
Yes. Actually,
I think so.
I've been preparing myself spiritually and mentally to doing ayahuasca, man.
Oof.
You've been calling me for years.
Yeah, man.
And I know that I should do it.
Yeah.
But you know when you're like, why am I scared?
Look, I'll say a couple things. Number one, a person like you, creativity, from our continent, because it resonates highly with people from our continent,
of course,
because that's where it's from, Amazon Basin. But a person of the drum, a person of music with your creativity and your faith, it's going to be fireworks.
Yeah.
So I would very much insist that you go there. I mean, I
tell you haven't been since for like 5 years.
Yeah. And I would tell anyone that. Now, the difference is for some people, I would probably say to them, you got some work to do before, you know. And a lot of people speak to me about it. But in your case, I probably haven't met anyone more ready than you. You understand what I'm saying?
And that's why I'm scared.
Yeah. Now, the second thing about being scared, a lot of people tell me that. And I actually would be more worried if someone said they're not scared.
Okay.
And what I mean by scared, I mean by probably respect more than scared, you know. It's a beautiful experience and one that not only do I think, you know, you should most definitely do, but also one that I would love to go with you.
Oh, man, I would definitely ask you to come for real.
Yeah, and Paulie knows and a lot of people know, you know, I do take that quite seriously and thankfully I have that the opportunity to do that. And with your case, I know, my friend, it's going to be an amazing thing if and when, God willing, and hopefully, bro, and obviously that's...
I dream about the other day, man.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, that's mama calling you.
The dream was like pretty much they say to me, we're waiting for you.
Yeah.
And I started to Google.
Good.
Like, what's that mean? Dreaming with ayahuasca, that they always doing ayahuasca.
Yeah.
And there's a calling.
It is as a calling.
I was like, wow.
Yeah. So, you know, I think a percentage of this show is always invested in speaking about ayahuasca, but for me, it's a life changer. And I know that's a worldwide thing for people from all walks of life, but actually the process of ayahuasca is magical, mystical, metaphysical, but it also works on a physical, psychological and emotional level. But the actual drinking and the ceremony is only one part of it. The main part is only one part of it. It actually starts before and after.
Wow.
You know, it can even start years before. And everyone has different kind of experiences and recalls things, you know, many different ways. But I'm not surprised at all that you're dreaming about it. And you know, and you know, whenever you want, my brother, we can make it happen. And yeah, man, we'll continue that conversation that started many years ago. But you know what, man? I think one of the cool things is obviously your career is extremely visual, man. So we've got like a ton of photos to show in our show and tell, which we love to do. So maybe we can get into that if Paulie's ready or if he's awake.
Just letting you know, I have a bit of a technical glitch.
Really?
So just bear with me.
Not a problem, man. I'm sure we can work with it. But you can see what we're seeing on the screen, no, Paulie?
Not really.
Well, if you look,
it's like micro.
But if you look up, dumbass.
Wait, don't say anything. Wait.
All right, cool. Yeah, man. So,
okay,
here we go.
Where's that? Is that the green button?
Yes, my brother. That's the green button right
there. Alrighty, yeah. Champ. Woo.
We can go on three now.
Go three. Yep.
Thank you, Paulie.
Go ahead.
We're throwing him in the deep end, man. I don't know what happened today. I think it's Chimbalada's energia.
Yeah, man.
He's fucking up our electronics in here, man.
Magnetic.
Yeah. All right, so. Some of our viewers or listeners tune in to us via Spotify and Apple Podcasts, and they can't see what we see. People on YouTube can see what we see. But so as we speak, I'll just digress a little bit and explain what it is that we're seeing. But Chimbalada, ball's in your court, man. This is all about you and what it is that you see and feel.
Oh, man, this is me and Leo Sucesso at the famous Carnaval Agaio.
Uh-huh.
You know, that was a moment that... I think that was just after the show, and we feel proud, man, for
of course
doing a great performance.
Lots of memories with this man, right?
Oh yeah, man, with Leo.
Very
definitely.
Unique energy and skill set.
Yes,
because incredibly talented human being, and also you know huge heart and super baiano, you know,
It's you know what's so funny watching this because it's it's so true when the people say everything eventually comes to the end.
Uh-huh.
And I look at these photos, I'm thinking like, oh man, what an awesome time.
What an awesome ride. Huh?
Yeah.
Beautiful stage in life. Yeah.
It's like, you know, it's...
Lots of good memories.
Yeah.
Yeah. Leo Sucesso, one of the more active members of Rhythm Brazil and many other bands, Brazilian bands.
Leo is from Brazilian roots, Eva.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Leo goes all the way back.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's the man. We love Leo. And nowadays he's doing sound engineering and stuff, right? He's doing...
He was. He still do, but he's actually
COVID,
doing a...
COVID would have finished that.
Yeah. He's actually doing a TAFE course. He's going to become a... What's it called? Marinheiro.
Sailor?
The...
Crewman?
The one that drives the ferry.
Okay. Oh, like some sort of captain.
Captain.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. Interesting, man.
I know. That's he told me. I was like, wow.
Man, that would be a cool ferry to catch.
Yeah.
And married as well. Shout out to Leo Sucesso.
Yeah, he's married, man.
And here's the brothers.
Oh, shit.
That's
that
our
was
birthday.
A good night, man.
Yeah, Margaritaville.
Yeah.
Ruben Sharp, Chimbalada.
That was, that's what I'm talking about, man. That was some memories you can't bring back.
Yeah.
You really can't, man.
Yeah, that was a cracker night, man.
Well, I feel like, I think we felt like we owned the shit, man.
Yeah,
we owned Sydney
back then. Well, plus you got to remember, you know, triple birthday celebration.
Yeah.
So it's not just, you know, one or two, it's three. And everyone at the time was very socially engaged. And I was running clubs and you were doing shows everywhere. And Eddie always out and about, you know what I mean? Dressing nice, looking nice. Everyone knows him. So,
Eduardo.
It was a real cool night, man.
He used to give you a lot of shit. I mean, Chimbalada, your boy, man. Fuck, man. He wants some more drink, man. I'm like, Eduardo, go easy, man. Rafa, too much, man. Like, he goes, oh, okay. I'm like, okay. Yeah. Go and talk to Rafa.
I haven't seen him in a long time, man.
Then he come back to me. He goes like, I just spoke to half of everything in school, man.
Yeah.
I'm like, what did you do? Because you're such a nice guy. You always, those things with a...
Yeah. And drink cards, I remember.
Did you? That's it. That's what I'm talking about.
Drink cards. Yeah.
Oh, but that... You can even see, like, I have this thing that is really creep, but...
Yeah.
On a good way. Yeah. I always look at foreigners and read the energy. The
aura. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The moment, look at our energy, man. Yeah, it's all like equally glowing. The same.
Yeah, 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 yeah. You know what I'm saying? Very much so, man. Yeah, of course, of course. Well, again, I mean, your birthday is 20?
23rd.
And his was 20?
27.
27, right? And mine's 22nd. Yeah. So that's why we threw the birthday together. Yeah, yeah. So my two Brazilian brothers there.
That's a show at the... What's the place called again?
That's Wharf 7, no? That's isn't that behind Circular Quay there? No, on the other side.
No, that's at... You tell me. Ulumulu.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Wow, no. On the other side completely. Yeah. Sure. Bit of capoeira there.
Just a warm-up before the show.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, with Luciano.
Uh-huh. Rhythm Brazil?
Yeah, Rhythm Brazil at Brazza. That's behind the stage.
Yeah, you guys done lots of gigs in Brazza, restaurant in Darling Harbour.
We've been there for 5 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
Mainly Saturday nights, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you guys go down to Brazza on a Saturday night for a good feed, you'll be able to catch the guys from Rhythm Brazil performing.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is pretty cool. Good way to end the night at dinner, man, in Darling Harbour.
Oh, Miami Fridays. Oh, that's a cool one.
I know what this is. This is when I launched one of my brands, Miami Fridays, a couple of years ago. Rhythm Brazil, they're my go-to crew, man, when I want to get the party started.
Yeah, man. Yeah. But you know what? Your parties was always the fucked up thing about my training. I wake up on Monday and I'm going like, man, you know what? For now, I'm going to train really hard.
Yeah.
I'm not going to stop.
That's right. Yeah.
Then Rafa called me on Wednesday. Timba, we have a show. Can you guys do a show on Saturday? I'm like, that's it.
Yeah.
Free drinks all night. I'm not going to say no to that.
You know what? Now I know why you motherfucker stopped showing up to all my fucking gigs. They'll send all the other boys. And of course, bro, everyone's good. It was all quality. But I used to say, how much money do I got to spend to get Timbalada? Is it a money thing? And they're like, yeah, man, dinero, okay, dinero. But that's what it is. It was running away from that. Man, the late nights are a killer, man. No doubt.
The good thing about your party was I felt at home.
Of course,
and
man.
Everyone, like all these people, they love you, man.
Yeah.
All of them.
It's
they love you.
Extended family, man. Yeah.
It's like when it was your party, everybody's like, man, it can't be, I don't care who is here.
Yeah.
Carlinhos, Salgueiro, whatever, we're going to Rafa. You know, it's like, because you feel at home, man.
Pretty good too, aren't they?
Huh?
His staff are pretty good too, aren't they?
It's
all Pauly.
Pauly was good, except that he used to give me one drink card.
One drink
card. That wasn't cool, man.
You can't do that,
man,
with Baianos, man. That's not cool, man. Bro. That's an insult.
You got to give me at least 20. You know what happened, Pauly? Half used to give me 20 cards.
Yeah.
And everybody, we have like 5 people performing.
Yeah.
I say, man, fucking Rafa only give me 5. And then everybody goes like, fuck, how is he only give one drink?
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, man, sorry.
Nah, but what I'm going to say is...
drinking moderation.
Yeah, no. Definitely when you boys got on the whiskeys and that and the beer, I knew the fucking party was on, man.
Yeah.
It wasn't every time, because a lot of the times it was pro. We do the show, we hang out, we take some photos.
Go home. Yeah.
And you got away from me.
Yeah.
But I knew as soon as they were like, oh, man, what do you want to drink? And you look at me like, yeah, give me some scotch or a couple of beers. And I was like, oh, all right, man, it's on. And then the Baiano thing comes out. And the Brazilian blood, and it was a long night of dancing and everyone following you guys on the dance floor and shit.
I think this, I stopped, because we were talking about this before, doing, because a lot of people don't understand this, they don't see this, but to actually doing 3-4 shows in a night, it's a killer, man.
Of course.
It's not physical, it's
everything.
The energy, before your party, I would come from 4 shows.
Yes, my brother.
And by the time I get there, I'm like, how much money is you going to give?
And I know that you guys, being who you are, you give everything.
100%.
You give, and that's the difference. The energy is the difference. So, man, I don't know how you guys have done it for such a long time, because it's true, especially on a Saturday night, right? You know, how many shows would you do?
Oh, at least before your parties in summer, at least 4 or 5 before we come to you.
That's insane.
That's why we got. That's why I get so pissed, man.
Yeah, yeah.
Drink because I'm like, I'm dead and of I'm course. Home. Yeah. And you are not going to judge me from being on the stage drunk.
No.
That's why I'm like, I can't actually do it.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
But you say that many times, you know that I forgot the shit. I go to the stage, Polly, and I look at my drum because I was doing the lead drums.
Yeah.
And I'm like, fuck, what do I do? And then Felipe was with, Felipe always play with me. I'm like, Felipe, get the hepniki. And I jump on the cache because it's easy.
Yeah,
you don't have to call anything.
That's right.
Because the lead drum.
Has you to lead.
You have to think what's coming next. Call,
yeah, that's right. You're ahead. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
When you answer,
yeah.
You don't have to think about
that's
anything.
That's right. You just follow me. That's right. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, man, so many
Which
times.
Which is another interesting thing about samba. The repiniki leads as in calls and then the other drums follow.
Yeah.
Answer. So there's that whole thing. Yeah. Yeah. Call and answer between, you know, which is ancestral, you know.
But fun, believe me or not, me going blackout only happens in your party. Every time I come with you, my God, interview, trademark.
Ooh, I know, man.
Yeah, I was before, at least 3 hours before showtime, I was already like, a lot of times I used to tell the boys, hey, I'm fucked. I'm gonna be behind you pretending. But you knew anyway. I knew that you knew.
Nah, he was on the I could see it in his face when he started looking down.
Yeah.
Like, ah, man, this nigga's fucked.
This is how Leo, actually, this is how Leo got to do the MC.
And leading,
Because he was every time. No, and he was always saving my eyes. He's like, Timba, what am I going to do? I'm like, man, they don't care. They love it. Whatever you want to do, just do it.
Ah, and he kills it too, man. Yeah, he got his own thing, man. Yeah, yeah. Leo Suceso.
Yeah.
I like copying his move. That Man, let's go back to the photos, please. How long ago is this, man? This looks like a much younger version of Timbalada. No,
that was Mardi Gras, man.
Maybe it's just the look.
Yeah, this is going to be I want this photo for the cover photo of my book.
Oh, really?
The front of the book.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I don't know if it's going to happen, but that's what
I
want.
That's why I chose it.
Good on your champ.
I made a lot of gay people happy that day. This was a Mardi Gras.
You guys, one of the awesome things you do is Mardi Gras, right? You've been doing it for a while.
We won the best choreography as well.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, once.
Sure. So, you know, in Sydney, Mardi Gras is a huge thing.
Yeah, that's Brazza again.
Again. You guys do a lot of photos backstage at Brazza, man.
That's the only place you can change me.
Okay, yeah. That's like one of the corridors, no?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And Mina, Sasha.
Yeah, Mina,
my man, Vinny.
Vinny, that.
Man.
You know how we talked about Leandro before?
Yeah.
Same energy same vibe.
Man.
Exactly the same vibe. Vinny. Guys is like
beautiful,
angel.
Man. Yeah.
The energy is on another planet,
man. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Beautiful Vinny people. Is like, Vinny is like you, for example, with me, as friends.
Click, yeah.
Yeah, but again, I mean, Vinny live away. Far away, he lives in Missouri.
Yeah,
it's like you live here, but we don't see each other that much because we got our own thing going on in life.
That's right.
But doesn't matter what, when we connect, this is what it is.
It's the same, yeah. Pick up where we left off. Yeah. Same with Vinny, yeah, man. Beautiful people, man.
Yeah.
Os Brasil, meus irmãos do Brasil.
Brasil.
E uma cubana aí, mina.
Uma cubana.
Doesn't he look like Vin Diesel a bit?
Enough. I get there a lot, man. Yeah. I used to get there a lot.
Uh-huh. You got to change your voice a bit, bro.
Yeah, man. always. Every time I've been like, oh, can I have a photo with Vin Diesel?
Really?
Like, yeah, sure.
Okay,
yeah.
No worries. Yeah, Timbalada's a lady killer from way back.
Oh, that was the first one, the formal party.
That, my friend, I think that is Ivy. Full moon party.
The watershed.
It was the watershed. Guys.
Yeah, because I didn't go to Ivy.
Okay. No. Yeah, of course this is. Yeah.
I think it was the first one or second one.
Nah, it's not the first one. The first one was a home nightclub and we hit capacity. It was a fucking disaster.
Wasn't that the I Love insane. Special edition first one?
You know what? You might be right, man. That's what it was. It was a Saturday night event we did for Full Moon Party, which, you know, for many years was fucking insane in Sydney.
Timbalada, Full Moon Party, Australia. Full Moon person guy.
Yeah, you're the guy.
I'm the guy. Look, I'm that guy.
There's a nickname. You know, in Brazil, everyone's got nicknames. Yeah. Yours is Timbalada because yeah. you play the chimbal. Yeah. His is the credit taker. He takes... he takes
sorry,
credit for got, everything,
you
man.
You got silence there, sorry.
I think it went off again. The microphone.
Yeah, but Full Moon Party Australia, always happy to have Rhythm Brazil.
Oh, this photo is interesting.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes, my brother.
Okay. Just make sure because something went off. This is the last show before COVID.
Oh, wow. Okay. So yeah. third week of March or second, yeah. second, third week of March. Okay, yeah. cool. Who would have known, huh? Who would have known?
Yeah. Well, the lady said to me, oh, we want to do a show. Like, can you guys still do a show? I'm like, oh, we're not supposed to, but we can.
True.
And when we got there, everybody was like so far away from each other.
Really?
I was like, fuck, maybe that's a mistake. We maybe shouldn't be doing that, you know?
Yeah.
But it was really at the beginning and we didn't touch anyone, so it's all good. Okay. But it was the last show.
Uh-huh. Hopefully it'll all be over soon, man.
Yeah.
Enough.
Oh, that's the famous carnival.
This is the last Brazilian carnival we did before the event. Hard Rock Cafe. That was, is it this year?
Yeah.
Yeah, 2020.
Last year.
February 2020. Was this year.
Oh my God, it is true. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, man. Yeah. It is. It is.
Looks
yeah.
like it's like it was a years
yeah,
ago.
Yeah, I know. It's crazy, right? The perception of time because of this COVID BS. All the beautiful ladies there from Rio Brazil always looking amazing. And that's a very popular spot for my dear photographer friend Celio to take his photos. He knew the venue well because we ran Candy there for quite a while. And the boys again at Brazilian Carnaval doing their thing. Timbalada, Leo Suceso.
Claudio Cartagena at the back.
That's him there, no?
Yeah.
Looks like he's got feathers on his head, but it's actually the photo. The photo behind it, no? Gracias, Pauli. He's another Brazilian Carnaval, but this time at Ivy.
Yeah. We killed that one, man. Yeah,
Ivy Courtyard. From memory, this is 2006.
Yeah,
16.
Man, people still talk about that night.
Yes,
that was the best event we did.
Yeah, no doubt, man. That was a monster.
Everyone
awesome
still
event. Yeah.
talk. People like, I still people still tell me.
Yeah.
Nobody doing carnaval the way that you guys did that.
Yeah. I hear you, man. And shout out to the brother Nick, who was one of the main sponsors. Yeah. And this was that same night. This is part of the thing was bringing Carlinhos Salgueiro from Brazil. Please tell us who Carlinhos is, Chimbo.
Oh, Carlinhos is the king. Of carnival,
yeah,
you know, he's one of no one, he's probably the most famous samba person in Rio,
sure,
in the world.
Choreographer,
dancer,
and personality.
And it's funny because he's created his own style, you know, he's famous because he took samba from here and took it to another level,
sure.
He added his own things,
and we brought him to Sydney. That year in 2016, and it was accompanied by workshops and everything, which you guys did really well.
Yeah,
and it was an amazing evening at the famous Ivy Courtyard in Sydney for Brazilian Carnival.
That was a crazy night. Again, one of the nights that I
got loose
blank on the happening.
You weren't the only one, man. This next photo, that's the brother Leandro Santos, whose story we were mentioning before, that was on Bondi Rescue, was made famous by Bondi Rescue. Yeah.
Barata.
Yeah.
Such a beautiful guy, man.
Barata was his nickname, huh?
Barata.
Yeah.
Like cockroach.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's Capoeira nickname.
Oh, okay.
Barata.
Barata. Yeah. I didn't know that. So, cucaracha in Portuguese is barata.
Barata.
It's one of those words that are completely different. Fins. Bali.
Yeah, that was a good experience. Very good experience, man.
Yeah.
Wow, that was actually an amazing experience.
I remember hearing about it when you came back.
Yeah.
You were like, wow, you know, yeah. So you guys went over there by the owners of Finn's Beach Club to do some gigs over there, right? Yeah. How long were you there for?
10 days.
10 days in Bali.
Yeah.
Pretty cool, man.
We performed there for 10 days.
Every night. Every day.
Yeah. Sure. I think we have 2 days off.
Oh, okay,
cool. I think we perform. Yeah.
Incredible venue, man, in Bali. I went there in January. And just a beautiful, well-run, well-presented, great venue. I went to most of the beach clubs in Bali, and Finns really blew me away. What's going on here, Timba?
Tony, Flavio, Afro.
Afro style, no?
Afro style. You can tell by the pants. I haven't used those pants for a while.
And Tony's a BJJ, no?
Yeah, he's brown belt.
Brown belt. BJJ, yeah. It's funny, man. You meet Tony, you talk to him. He's a nice guy. He's humble, and he doesn't look threatening in any way. But you know, little do you know that he was
a UFC fighter, man.
He's an anaconda motherfucker. Yeah. You know,
he actually fought at the UFC.
Oh, really?
Yeah, man. He did.
I had no idea, man.
Here, in Australia.
Really?
Yeah, he's a real fighter.
I had no idea, bro. Yeah. Oh, man, I'm going to start treating him even nicer now. Shout out to Tony, man. He's my brother, man. Nah, he's got that calm.
Episode 18.
He's a nice guy, man.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful. And Flavio always showing off that crazy physique of his, man. Yeah.
We call Flavio the Rei Leão. The Lion King.
Yeah. Rei Leão. Shout out to Flavio as well, man. Right, Tim Bailey.
Oh, yeah.
Channel 10, News Weather.
Back on the days we used to do a lot of TV stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That's Tim Bailey. We actually did a lot of stuff with Tim Bailey.
Yeah.
They always used to call us back on Bacardi Fiesta as well.
Yeah, I remember.
We always get a phone call. Oh, can you guys do a segment with us?
Across, yeah. That's pretty cool, man. Cool gigs you guys have done.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Ooh. Bondi Latin Festival, Fiesta. That was another good gig, man.
Bondi Latin Festival, this is the year that I ran it with Dwight. I think this is 2012, February 2012, and remembered by many as the best edition of that festival. It's been run by many different parties over the years, but that one definitely... I'm pretty sure with confidence I can say it was the biggest attendance, because we did about 3,500 people over the course of the day. Weather always is a big factor.
Yeah.
But also just the fact that it was run by two people with, you know, with their finger on the pulse in the community and knowing what works and what doesn't. And Dwight bringing his elements, which are more, you know, salsa world and whatever. And then myself coming from, you know, reggaeton, Brazilian, you know, all that experience over the years. It was just a... awesome day, and of course the weather again was a huge factor, but all you guys blowing them away, and this is as usual, you know, a headline act, you know, you guys closed the festival, you know, so
yeah,
that was amazing.
Such a shame that it finished, man.
Yeah, over the years it's just been getting worse and worse, and you know, it's just embarrassing to see what it's become from where it's come from, but you know, I think that's just poor management. This is the previous year's
Ivy.
Carnival at Ivy. Not 2016, this is 2015.
Yeah. Actually.
When you guys came out in the t-shirts.
I think it was Brazilian Day. Yeah. I don't know if it was Carnival or Brazilian Day.
I'm pretty sure this is Carnival.
Was it
just
Carnival?
Just because I remember the dancers on the roof.
Yes, yeah. Sorry.
Yeah, 2015, you're right. Without Carlinhos. This was just the local lineup. Yeah, crazy event. Confetti, they would have been cleaning that confetti for fucking days.
Yeah.
As Paulie likes to make venues do. He's a proper freak. Uh-huh.
Oh, man.
I took this photo.
That was so long time ago.
Yeah, man. 2014.
What's it called?
What? Ah, this is Martin Place.
No, the Columbia... place that was right next to it.
No, not right next to it, but you're talking about Colombia Organica.
Colombia Organica.
Pedro's place. Pedro who had on the show.
Oh yeah, because this is Martin Place.
But this is Martin Place, and this is an event that you and I ran,
which
was fucking epic.
Yes.
Yeah? Except for when Brazil lost to Germany in the end, but epic as far as, you know, I've never done an event which ran... you know, not every night for the whole World Cup, because there was even nights when, you know, there was no matches, especially week 3 and 4. And then some of the nights when some of the smaller teams were playing, not representing in Australia. But, you know, I remember sleeping in the car in the car park at Darling Harbour.
Yeah.
Because it was just every fucking night almost.
I don't think, I don't remember anybody come up with a concept for party like that.
No.
It definitely was the first time I ever saw.
Yeah. And it was, you know, we had all the major TV networks covering the event. For the final, we had ABC Radio broadcasting live from the final. It was just insane. And then obviously being played in Brazil, we were finishing as people were going to work. So there'll be film crews outside filming you playing the drums.
Yeah.
The sun's coming up. It's 6 a.m, you know. We've been partying all night. And here come the cameras and people. It was funny. I was watching tradies and that go to work. And here we were out in the footpath, out in the streets in Darling Harbour, dancing to samba drums and everything. It's like...
It was crazy, man.
Crazy.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I remember I was so tired every single day. Yes.
Yeah, man.
Oh, wow. Yeah. There.
And there it is. That's obviously inside. We used to sell merchandise at the event. You know, we used to sell all the scarves and the beanies. Shout out to my boy, Andrico Nicola.
That was a good time too.
Yeah, it's Felipe Faria.
Yeah.
Rodrigo.
Rodrigo, Vini. Leo, Vito.
There's a boy. Shout out to Vini, man. VR Productions.
Yeah.
Both of them in this photo here. And all the lovely ladies, of course. Beautiful Nana.
That was Sasha. Before VR? No. I think they already... Oh, no, they help us, didn't they?
Yeah. I mean, you know, I think VR... Productions took shape sometime after that, as in properly.
Yeah, yeah,
you
know, yeah.
They've been killing it ever since. But yeah, there's the boys and great, great times again. That's World Cup 2014, Carnival, yeah. World Cup Carnival 2014 in Margaritaville.
Yeah, that was good times. Oh, the Olympics.
I see the Olympic rings.
Star City. That was a good high profile. Sure.
So again, a testament to Rhythm Brazil's success in Australia is... This is for the Olympic Games in Brazil. So obviously that Brazilian samba flavor was coming through. So who do they call? They call you guys.
Yeah.
And this was to launch. That was a couple for the of launches, no?
Olympic commitment.
Okay. Committee.
Committee, yeah.
Olympic committee, yeah. Because you guys did also the launch for some of the
for
gear.
The soccer.
And yeah, the soccer.
That was after, probably in the same month.
Around the same time, obviously. Yeah. Next one.
That's me, meditation, man. Time to recharge.
Very important part of life, huh?
Yeah, man.
Sponsored by G-Star.
Yeah. True.
My man.
I love this photo, man.
Oof.
Oh, wow.
Again, Brazilian Carnival, Ivy, 2016. There's the boys. There's me too, jumping in there. Smile ear to ear, probably because we put about 2,500 people through the door and I was already counting.
Getting your shirt off.
The best.
Yeah, they tried.
Party ever.
Yeah, man.
This one, man.
That was crazy. Yeah, it was great times. The boys obviously getting painted up a bit more tribal for this one.
Yeah.
What's my security guard's name?
Luciano. Luciano looks scary.
He always looks scary, but he's got an anti-smile policy, no smiling photos policy. Yeah. That's right. Try and break the camera. Beleza.
That's the canola shark.
So again, Rhythm Brazil doing big gigs in Sydney.
Yeah.
In Australia. What else we got there? Oh, okay.
Leandro.
Sure. He's the brother Leandro that was injured. This picture was much later, obviously, than the original photo of him.
He's that photo is in Brazil somewhere.
Sure.
Yeah.
So this is the brother, you know, in a wheelchair, you know, doing his best with his condition. Wow. Which came about from the accident in Bondi.
That's a welcome the athletes from the Olympic.
Oh, the welcome back. When they
got back from Brazil, yeah.
Wow. Again, Rhythm Brazil, Sydney, Sydney Opera House. Great times. And another feather in the cap for Rhythm Brazil that's done everything there is to do in Australia. Brother, what's... I mean, I know with COVID and everything, it's a little bit more challenging to say what plans, you know, for the future. But where's Timbalada at in 2020 and how you're looking at coming out of all of this? Because we are now sort of seriously thinking about coming out of these things. I know myself, events are starting to happen. What's the feeling? What's the mood? And where do you see the future in the next few years for you and for everyone, for the world?
Well, as for Rio Brazil, we have a big break, like for COVID.
Sure.
Like it's been like 6 months. Sure. But now it's slowly, the shows are starting to come back again.
Sure.
We just launched a new website.
Yes, rhythmbrazil.com.au.
That's right. And slowly, I'm starting build Rhythm Brazil again.
Sure.
Differently.
Uh-huh.
Because now my mind, it's not so much focus on being popular and being famous.
Sure.
It's more focus on just doing what I love.
Sure.
So definitely Rhythm Brazil is coming stronger than ever.
Awesome.
But with a different intention.
Sure, sure. Yeah. And ultimately intention is in life is, you know.
Make people smile, make people happy.
Yes, my brother, yeah.
And also fulfill my soul, man.
Yes, indeed.
Because I try, indeed. Like, you know,
yeah.
When I have a break, I've been working construction. Uh-huh. And, you know.
Yeah.
And it's good, you get the money, but for someone like
you're
me.
You're not fulfilled at all. It's not creative.
I gotta do creative. My shows too.
Yeah, I hear you, bro. No, I think it would be a crime to humanity. For people like you not to be earning a living from, or at least not to be properly engaged in their yeah. craft. Because if there's one thing I would definitely say, you were born to do, Jimba, with the utmost respect, is play music, man.
Yeah.
You know, and to entertain. And hopefully there's a platform for you, as limited as this country is for that kind of thing, as blessed as we are, but as limited as it is specifically in cultural music and the arts, let's say. I hope that there's a space for you to be creative and not just play, you know, the let's call them the everyday gigs, as awesome as they are. I would love to see you doing more depth, you know,
yeah.
to be able to play. I mean, I've seen you guys play as a Bachida da Rua.
Yeah.
Man, you guys fucking rocked the yeah. house, man. That was incredible. I've never heard a Brazilian band play that. I mean, there's lots of great musicians, yeah. lots of great bands. Samba Roots and all these guys have done great things. But what I saw with Bachida,
yeah.
man, that was fucking powerful, yeah. man. Yeah.
It's because it's real, man. It's
yeah.
real energy
yeah.
coming from the soul.
Yeah, that's right, man. But also, I mean, I know you've done lots of like drum workshops and stuff like that. Nothing like that in the near future?
I don't think I'm going to be doing much drum workshop
sure.
because it's hard work, man.
Yeah.
It's like when you're doing a workshop, you have to carry around 50 drums. It's,
yeah, I'm sure.
It's
yeah.
hard and yeah. it's not something that happens every week.
Sure.
So for me, it's like...
Okay.
I still do it,
it's
but...
It's not really flowing
yeah.
for you. Okay, cool. And the book...
The book is finished, bro.
Wow.
It's finished.
Finally, huh?
I was just speaking to Ingrid, my writer.
Shout out to Ingrid.
Yeah. I was speaking to her 3 days ago.
Sure.
She said, it's finished, but we keep taking to different people to look at the book and give their opinion, what sure. they think,
yep.
how should we change.
Yeah.
So it's
a slow process, bro.
It's long, yeah.
Yeah, it's a slow process.
It's been happening for 4 years.
Yeah.
And it's still not done.
Yeah. The name of the book?
Rhythm of Life.
Rhythm of Life. Right, yeah. Beautiful. So that's something for people to look out for out there.
It's actually interesting because the book, as I told you before, I think, it's going to be talk about Genival
yeah.
and Timbalada.
Okay, sure, yeah.
Me
Genival, which is your real name.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Timbalada, who's the on stage.
Yeah.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
So it's going to be very interesting, man.
Okay, cool, man. Yeah.
So, yeah.
So I would be right to say that Genival is the emotion, the personal journey,
yeah.
the suffering,
that's,
you know, all yeah. your journey as a kid and
yeah.
your, you know, all the pitfalls and the
yeah.
drama and the troubles and your mama passing.
Yeah.
And that transformation into Timbalada.
That's right.
You know, which is what came after, which is the showman, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah. Cool, man. Look, very much looking forward to reading that, my brother. I hope that happens very Ooh, soon.
Me too, man. I can't yeah. wait. Because actually, my idea after that, yeah. when I launched the book, I wanted to also launch my own charity.
Okay, sure.
So I want to help...
like a non-for-profit, like a charity.
Yeah, non-for-profit sure.
yeah.
charity,
yeah.
which we'll call Rhythm of Life. where I give it back to the street kids in Brazil.
Oh, wow, man. Yeah, full power to you, my brother.
That's what I want the book to finish.
Yeah. And then that will unlock a whole bunch of things.
That's
right.
Yeah, cool. So I want to go back there.
Well, my friend, you know, I often say to myself, you know, I wish on this side of the world, I wish in our circles, I wish in our everyday people that we're all surrounded by here, whether it be in Sydney or my friends in South America, wherever I am, I always look and I think, wow, man, wouldn't it be cool to have like more documentary makers and people to do things, to shine lights on these things and, you know, for media to tell all these local stories, because your story is one that I think definitely is worthy of, you know, that kind of limelight and that kind of exposure. I think it would be an amazing ride. And if anyone out there is listening that's from that world, man, maybe link up, check out the book, you know what I mean? Yeah. And then, you know, usually these things come off the back of books, man. So I feel that, like, that's going to unlock a whole bunch of, you know, doors for you. And God willing, infinite abundance, my brother. And I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for joining me on the show today, man. It's been a real honor, real pleasure.
Thank you for having me here, man.
Yeah, man. It's always amazing to be with you, around you, Timbalada. Today, even more so because, you know, uninterrupted by bloody phones and life and everything, man. So,
producer.
Yeah. The producer starting shit.
And shout out to that fly.
It's okay.
Bugging us the whole night.
Well, you know, us humans, we want to be completely surrounded by nature, but we don't want nature, like, you know.
That's
what I mean?
That's so crazy.
Yeah, funny. Yeah, but no, Chimba, obrigado, meu irmão, de coração. Love what you do, man. Love who you are, and I look forward to seeing so much more from you, man, because I know you got a lot to give. Full power to you, man, in everything that you do, man. And again, God willing,
thanks, man. Thank you.
Much more beautiful things for us to do together.
Same to you, man. Same to you, everything. You know that I love you, bro.
I love you.
Doesn't matter
what.
Yeah, man. And don't forget.
Tell me.
Two dates. Buqueca and feijoada.
My man.
Paulie, you coming too, mate?
Yeah. Well, we might do one at your house and one here.
Let's do
you
it.
Just get all the ingredients, you know?
Cool.
Yeah, you can do a cook-off with the beautiful tao as well. That's pretty good in the kitchen. Pretty good.
Cool.
Understatement. <All right. laughs> Before we go, we just want to send a big thank you to our foundation sponsors, Q Corp Construction, Crash Claim, meeting new friends by accident, Open for Australia. Shout out to Pedro Munoz and the whole team taking care of student visas and how to travel to Australia, and really looking after the whole student market here in Sydney and in Latin America. Open for Australia. Shout out to them. And also to our partners at the Variant Collective, man. Shout out to Variant Collective. Thank you so much for everyone at home for listening, for watching us. Timbalada, one more time, man. Thank you, my brother. Love you, man. And Paulie.
Yeah, boss.
Thank you so much, man. God bless you too, meu irmão. Thank you for everything you do for us, man. Keeping up with
Dale.
Keeping up dale. With our bullshit as we talk here for hours.
There was a lot of energy in this room today.
Energia!
I wish you brought your drums too, man.
Actually,
I was thinking, you know what I was thinking?
Okay.
I should have some girls and some drums. Next one, man.
Man, if anyone can make it happen, it's you, man.
When we're doing the launch of the book, if you invite me back here, I bring the girls.
That's
bring a little success, and we have a little bit of...
I don't need an excuse, man. You can come back here anytime you want. No, but I was actually going to think it would be cool to get the drums and Leo, because look, we can definitely do two. If you, three will start getting a bit uncomfortable, but, you know, you and Leo, some drums, and we can talk about, you know, yeah, man, definitely. We'll call it the Baiano Takeover.
I'm keen to do it.
Thank you, man.
Sure.
God bless, my brother. Paulie, thank you again, and thank you everyone at home,
thank
man.
You,
thank you. Gracias. Beleza. Pretty cool, huh?
Oh, man.
Hey.
Man, I've been holding my pee for like 5 hours.